Hey guys, welcome to Four Nerds, and this is Samantha Wynn.
Mute him now.
So thank you guys for showing up another week of the
floor. No, oh, okay. Stop.
Here we go. Yeah, I was just watching Dawson at the bottom getting ready for this through the intro and shit. What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Four Nerds. We are three nerds right now because the fourth one, like,
and it's a better show. It's a better show.
As a matter of fact, you know,
he probably showed up in the chat.
Yeah, is he in the chat?
No, but he will be. He will.
Yeah, he probably will be. This episode of Four Nerds was really just to say that we've decided to replace Andre with this dude right here, Phil.
Yo, yeah, welcome. But he's all dressed up and he's got his blazer on.
This is what professionalism looks like.
Yeah.
Me? Hell no. I mean, did you
my tag is unfiltered. I'm not fucking professional. Come on.
I mean, look at this guy. He wears his sunglasses at night.
Yes. Inside during the day.
Yeah. Inside. Where he lives at is still pretty much. Well, shit, it's still daylight out.
And full disclosure, yeah. I just found out I'm replacing Andre. So that's news to me. So.
But it's good news.
Yes.
You're the boss.
No, don't call him the boss. He's the boss around here. No shit.
I cut the checks.
I was at work today, and one of my other coworkers, like, I work in a warehouse, and, like, you know, one of my coworkers, he had nothing to do, and, you know, Labor Day weekend coming up, like, there's a lot of that going around our effect. Like,
we're finishing up Labor Day.
Right, and he's like looking at everyone, like, what do I do? And he's looking at me, and I'm looking at him, like, dude, I ain't the fucking boss. What are you doing? Like, go find someone with authority to find something to do. I'm not, just because I sit here at the end of the line, don't make me line leader.
See, on the opposite side, we're like, I'm the very end of the line where, like, I package all the material and stuff. So, like, nobody even sees when I'm there because I'm past, like, the wall of plastic that goes down and everything.
How can nobody see you when you're 6'5"?
Did you miss the part where there's a wall of plastic between my section and everybody else in the line?
Or are you gargantuan? Deaf? Oh, you mean Dawson?
Official Ryan's deaf.
what up everybody, another episode of Four Nerds. Let's see who's in the chat, see who's here. Fear Jason says let's go.
Yes. Yeah, let's go.
DC Talk, what's good, homie? What's
how you doing?
Phillip in the chat.
Oh, hey, hi.
We got to get him on the show.
Oh man, I heard he's a great guy, but he's kind of an asshole too, so I don't know.
okay so I heard the same.
Can't be worse than
what
nicotine.
Up, guys? What up, man? What's up? Fire.
Yes, what's up? What's up, y'all?
James said, finally made it to an episode. Hey, appreciate you stopping by.
Nice.
Jason, fire. Yes, fire.
What's funny is that the show is at the same time and the same day every week, yet Andre fails to see that.
What up, how many times you missed, Ryan?
I've missed because I had to. But no, actually, I showed up later, just like he will hopefully show up later. But yeah,
fingers crossed.
Surge, what's good? What's up,
Surge?
Hello, what up, Surge?
It's good to see
the regular Miller in the house.
Like JP and Rebel Boyle are hiding against them.
Hey, JP's middle name is Philip. Let's not forget that.
There you go. Oh,
so yeah, man, we got a few things to talk about. There's some little bit of news. There's a certain director said some shit today that I was just like, oh.
Yeah, I heard that. Yeah. Steven really Spielberg.
If only.
Speaking of which.
That's not cinema.
I mean, to be fair, he was the first one to comment about it, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's at still making his movie, right? That wasn't like a it was a comic book based movie that he was making.
Oh,
for Black Hawk.
There you go. Yeah, there you go.
So with that, I just want to bring this up that somebody dropped out there that I thought was pretty. It was made me laugh. Okay, it's this right here. It says this one of the Wonder Woman 4 is actually 10 out of 10 if you stop the movie right after this scene right here.
I don't know. I had a problem with that one scene. I like it. Yeah, it was fire. But there was, I forget what it was. I remember, you'll have to go look at my
review. I hate it and I don't know why.
No, I don't hate it.
That was my problem with this movie.
Something that was
this was my problem with this movie in that this was the only bit of Themyscira I got. I was like,
yeah, you want some more?
Where's the island? Like, I need more of this.
I mean, they showcased it in such a great way and then it was never shown again.
I think it was like when they caught her at the end and didn't let her win. I thought that was good, but I thought that the pep talk after that totally killed everything that they said before. Like you know, you can't cheat your way through it, but you're the most special person in the world, and you're going to be a hero, and this other, you know, whatever. I forgot what it was, but it was something along those lines. But yeah, that's
just like I got it, like understanding like the truth of the like reality, and it's like, okay, yeah, sure, the way it kind of comes together in the end though, that's a little more questionable.
yes garbage.
Speaking
of garbage, Anthony Belcher loves
saying
garbage,
that. Oh, I thought you were gonna say air's Anthony.
She loves saying that.
I was like, he's cutthroat. This is the second week that he's been cutthroat.
Like that movie has like a really solid cast, and like they just were not handed really great material to work with. Like I love Pedro Pascal and I love Kirsten Wiig, but like that movie, it's.
Well, see, I was talking to Andre earlier about, because I watched for you guys. I watched you guys on the panel, The Amazing Spider-Man. I watched the first one again last night. Okay. And that's why I missed Irregular Neil. He hit me up. He was like, yo, I got a show. I was like, like an hour later, I was like, hey, what time is it? It was already done. So I was okay. But I watched it and I was like, you know what? They had some really good dialogue and really good interaction. It just, the story just didn't mesh for me that much. I think that the dialogue was great, and the delivery, the you know, chemistry. I loved you know, Gwen Stacy's dad. You know, he was the comedian. I forget what his name is.
What's
his name? I remembered it earlier today, but then I was like, what is his name? But anyway, he did a great job.
Gwen's dad.
Yeah,
oh, Dennis Leary.
He's a comedian. I remember back when he was like on MTV doing all that crap.
You know, I actually really liked him as Captain Stacy.
I thought he really brought a lot. Yeah. Him and Martin Sheen brought the most, and Sally Field, but she was number three. But they brought the most weight. As far as like, I think Dennis Leary and then Martin Sheen and then Sally Field.
Yeah.
And I thought they did great. The the lizard, he was fine.
Siphons was actually I liked him a lot in that role. I thought he did a really nice play of like, you know, tormented father who obviously can't see his own kid, but he did crazy pretty well.
Yeah.
I did absolutely. Like
it was good. But then again, the same thing was like, you know, it had fire, you know, CG.
Yeah.
But just the story wasn't exact. I was like, and then I forgot. I was like, remember when I was saying like that Peter Parker in this incarnation, he's kind of an outcast, but he's still too cool. I forgot. Like he totally destroyed the basketball goal, but then I forgot he destroyed the football goal too. And I was like, wait a minute. I was like, he's like way too cool. I was like, no, dude, that's not Peter Parker.
What is your definition of cool?
Cool is not showing off in front of everybody like he did.
He's learning his powers. He can't help it sometimes. He's just like instinctively doing it. He's just becoming Spider-Man. No,
with the basketball, you know.
There's plenty of examples like that in the comics where he does something ridiculous because he's just doing
genuine offensive. Question, Ryan. Have you ever ridden or done anything on a skateboard?
Yes.
So you're too cool to be a nerd.
I'm not too cool.
I'm just curious.
that's normally at the end of riding the skateboard. That's normally how I finish.
I used to skate for a really long time, and I used to do some pretty technical stuff on the ground. I was pretty much a ground skater, so I'm just curious.
Yeah. So yeah, no, like, I did. Okay. Back when they were, you know, when you rip them off and then you give the bottom board to Marty. Yeah. So those are my skateboards. Yeah. That's just what I thought. I thought that was, I like the first one better than the second one. The second one I didn't like as much.
The second one's,
Jamie Foxx really killed it for me.
It's tough. That second movie's a tough watch. I'll say that much. A lot like Wonder Woman 84.
Yes.
Nice segue.
Yes. No. Amazing Spider-Man 2, Wonder Woman 84, pretty much on par. They had
same directors for both films.
Ooh, yeah, you're right. Phoned it in.
I wouldn't even say phoned it in. I would just say that the second film, if you think about both films and what they were like aiming to do, Amazing 2 was aiming to try and set up like a Sinister Six, a Spider-Man 3 and 4, this, that, and the other thing. But then you've got like Wonder Woman 84. It's Patty Jenkins, Jeff Johns. Like, I need to make Wonder Woman in the 80s. And it's like, you can kind of see where the studio had a bigger hand in what the movie should have been as opposed to maybe what the director really wanted to do. Now, that's not to say that Webb and Jenkins did not want to do, you know, 84 and Amazing 2, but it's definitely abundant to me that those films were a lot more like studio being like, sequel?
Yeah. Yeah, they probably came to him. They were like, well, we got a list of things that you need to add to the film, and here's one of them. And Dawson, you wanted the rhino, right? Yes. Okay, Dawson wants the rhino. And...
I need him
to have a horrible accent.
I understand what you're saying about Electro, but even then, he's the best villain in the movie. Like, when you really think about it, he's the better villain.
Yeah.
I mean, for nothing. Dane DeHaan's a pretty solid actor, but man, that Green
Goblin. He did better in Chronicle.
Yes.
I thought he was more menacing. And I was more afraid of him. Like, oh my God.
And the Metallica movie he was in, that was sauce. He was really good in that, but. Yeah, Amazing 2 has some...
Just the worst thing about his portrayal of Goblin was the makeup. I think the makeup, the presentation of it just wasn't on par. I think so far, we have not seen a really good interpretation of the Green Goblin or even Green Goblin 2 on screen.
I can agree to that.
Yeah.
The only thing that's fire is the glider of Spider-Man, the first Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. That glider was dope. Yep. But the costume sucked, the helmet sucked. And then the snowboard that that what's his name was riding.
yeah.
Goblin Jr.
James Franco.
I've talked too much about it
in his paintball gear.
I'm not gonna do it again.
So James says, did you think everyone's acting in Spider-Man 1-3 was superb? No.
You compare the acting in those to the Amazing Spider-Man movies.
I'll just go to one comment really, really fast.
I think the only one in Spider-Man 3 that was really deserving of like doing a good job as far as acting is concerned is Thomas Hayden Church.
Yeah.
I think he's the only one that really wanted to be there.
Well, I don't know. You know, you got Willem Dafoe as Green Goblin. Norman Osborn.
Was he in the mirror or where was he?
If you're counting like all three films.
No. I was counting just Spider-Man 3. Out of all the actors in Spider-Man 3.
Oh, okay.
I think Thomas Hayden Church was the only one that really came and brought it as far as like, you know, giving a good performance.
Yeah.
So I think Toby, you know, kind of phoned it in. I think
I can agree with Toby.
I think that Franco phoned it in. I think that
I don't know. I don't know.
What's his name?
Who? That's your favorite word, isn't it, Anthony?
I think the guy from That 70s Show phoned it in.
Oh, Topher Grace.
Topher Grace.
Remember the particular scene in that movie where she's like, hit me over the head, and Franco's like, she's like, I'm like, what are we fucking watching right now? Like, that shit was so weird, like such a weird scene in there. But
Jameson was fire.
He's like
Simmons was always going to deliver in that, no matter what.
Yeah.
So,
in fact, when we were rewatching the first Spider-Man movie, J.K. Simmons gets on screen. And it was just like every second of him in that movie is pure gold, honestly.
People born to play roles, put him in that same list.
Yeah, he did a great job. And I would love to see him really. And that's the only reason why I give a shit about Batgirl is because I want to see more of J.K. his Simmons, character. Yeah. I want to see him, you know, flesh out Jim just like you fleshed out J. Jonah Jameson. I'm in 84. Well, I mean, it's called COVID-19 for a reason. So, I mean, there's been 2021 every year. It's a different COVID strand. So, okay, whatever. So the 84 would be right.
So 84 is when Ryan will not be around anymore.
Yeah, they'll finish exterminating the planet. Yes,
more than likely.
It's just Patrick needs to admit you can't do it without Snyder. The only reason people stop shitting on the movies because, I mean, so if you guys missed it, there's some comments that came out where it's just like, talking shit about movies that go straight to streaming. Like she said, like something like they don't exist to her.
I got the whole quote. It's absolutely just baffling, honestly.
Yeah, I had the tab open and I accidentally closed it. So there's that.
So the quote is,
what is it? What, who?
Oh, that's Andre.
Who is this?
Ignore him.
Oh, that face.
Wow. There he is. What's going on, you guys?
What's up, dude?
What up?
How are you doing?
Good.
Attention for 5 seconds.
I know. Well, no, I'm so glad to jump on here because I've been meaning to tell you guys, you know, The Amazing Spider-Man 2 sucks.
Oh, man. See? I'm not going to go that far. I'll admit the movie has flaws, but I'm not going to shit on it.
What did you compare it to?
That's not nice.
You compare Wonder Woman 84. I don't think it's that bad.
I don't own either of those films.
I have both of these Spider-Man movies, and I have The Amazing Spider-Man 2 in 3D, which is like whatever. I don't think it's as bad as Wonder Woman 84, but I think that Jamie Foxx's character, Electro, I thought his character portrayal was very Wonder Woman 84-ish. Everything else, I mean, and both villains sucked. They were just very cheesy. They weren't done very well. But
any of you ever consider that all of you suck?
That's the answer. I think after Spider-Man what was it called? Amazing Spider-Man 2. I think after that, Jamie Foxx is going to go on as and star as Eric Bishop. So I think he's going to change his name back to his birth name.
Oh, they brought him back.
He just want to be brought up.
Ryan, you've been striking out left and right with your jokes. I'm telling you right now.
I appreciate that. I mean,
You said one earlier about the hoverboards and nobody laughed.
Yeah, no. I think I was the only one that's a Back to the Future fan. So I was like, okay.
Rough crowd, man.
You do see Anthony's license really plate that he has, right? Of Back to the Future.
I know. And I was like, man, he didn't get it.
We all got it. We just didn't think it was funny.
And I was like, oh, damn. Tough crowd. It's all right, though.
Yeah. But so she made the comments and
back to what we were talking about.
Yeah, I've got the one quote here, but there's a whole LA Times article that this is apparently pulled from. But the quote that everyone's going nuts over, and it's pretty backhanded, honestly. All of the films that streaming services are putting out, I'm sorry, they look like fake movies to me. I don't hear about them, I don't read about them. It's not working as a model for establishing legendary greatness.
Guess what movie was a streaming movie?
Fucking Zack Snyder's Justice League.
Yeah,
that doesn't exist to you now. Is that fake?
Last year alone, Trial of the Chicago 7. You've also got that was either last year or this year. You've also got Mank from David Fincher. Mm-hmm. That's Fincher, isn't it? Yeah,
Fincher. Yeah.
So then you've now also got now she's also essentially saying that anything on HBO Max upcoming DC wise is also not real. Okay, cool. So the Black Canary film that I'm looking forward to, you're not calling that real? Thanks, Patty. Appreciate that.
Yeah.
Can't wait to see Star Wars Rogue Squadron on premium access. Yeah, I hope.
Very ill-advised statement there. Like, very short-sighted. It's like, look, like I get being honest, just saying like, oh, you don't pay attention to stuff that goes on stream platforms, but like to see them as fake movies, like movies that have been going straight to streaming recently, like you look at them and there's a lot of great quality to them. Yeah. CGI is great. Acting is great. Like they're legitimate films. Like so there's still a way to do that with streaming.
She just slapped Army of the Dead in the face too. And it's like, yeah, really? Like, come on. Like,
come on. In a way, I think what she's saying is that like, you know, when you watch a movie on TV, it sort of takes away from the epic scope of it. And maybe maybe through her eyes, it's like, yeah, it feels like I'm just watching a TV movie and it's not the same. But, you know, when you look at the optics of what she's saying, it's kind of like, hey, you know, you got to think about what you're saying in terms of like whose other movies have been put on streaming services and, you know, give them respect as well. It's kind of a backhanded statement. I didn't really care for it. I think she needed to be a little more tactful with what she was saying, but I get it to a degree, but I was bad take Patty.
Yeah.
Bad take Patty.
And honestly,
kind of like bad take Ryan, but not as bad.
Oh yeah.
Not only that, like how do you say something like that, especially after what happened with 84, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Oh God. Mm-hmm. Ryan loves that movie.
Well, it was dope. You know, I like the I don't know if y'all saw the comment that I
Mannequin Arms, there. Play it.
Mannequin Arms. Oh. Yeah, I played it earlier.
Oh yeah, we already played. When you were
action out. Sequence I've ever seen in my entire
life. Actually, I'm sorry, but they got an Emmy. Was it an Emmy or an Oscar for that?
No. They got nominated for some stuff. Like
nominated.
Remember, I don't have the list anymore.
Yeah,
but there was a nominated. List of like nominations like, for.
What?
And it said visual effects, and I was like, wait, or no, stunt
quarters. Stunts. Yes.
I was like, wait, are we talking about the same movie? Because I don't see.
Yeah.
So, did you talk about the same movie where this took place? Believe it or not, I'm
walking on air. A scene that Patty Jenkins fought for. She said, "No, Warner Brothers, you're not going to change my movie. I'm keeping the mall scene in the movie."
She said, "This has to be seen in the home."
Dude, in reality, I wish that mall in the home. I wish that mall scene would have been a deleted scene. Because I mean,
the whole scene was not needed.
You could have cut the whole scene out of the movie.
Whole scene.
You could have cut the whole scene out, and the movie would not have changed whatsoever. The only difference is that
it probably would have been more fire. It probably would have been a lot better because they would have had to explain a different location of how they found the artifact,
right?
And not a fucking mall.
It would have been a slower movie because they wouldn't have an action piece in the beginning.
It wouldn't have opened with a bad take. Well, it opened with the Themyscira scene, but then it wouldn't have like that. That's like still at the beginning, like giving you a kind of a bad taste.
Yeah,
going forward.
Giving you a bad taste. Yeah.
I think that the stunt team, kind of go off in Anthony Beltre's comment, was limited because we do know that. Damon Caro worked on the stunts for that movie. Damon Caro is a stunt coordinator for all of Zack Snyder's films, including the DCEU. So I think just with what they wanted to do with the film itself, I think they were limited as to like how they could do the stunts and make it in a way to where it was convincing. I just think it was a tricky situation stunt coordination wise.
Yo, Serena did her tennis commercial is a way better job at that scene. Have y'all seen that?
I saw bits of it.
Yeah, she's dressed as Wonder Woman in the mall, like hitting tennis balls. It's than that. It's better than that.
That's bad.
Yeah. So who knows what's gonna happen with like the next one? Because just like, yo, the ultimate director that you probably wouldn't be surprised to say something like this would probably be Nolan. Nolan's never said – he said some things as far as, like, wanting to see movies are supposed to be on the big screen. He's never said anything like this. He's never said that movies that are on streaming services, they just kind of don't exist. Like, wait, what?
Calling them fake. Like,
yes, calling them fake. He's never went that far because he realizes that Scorsese has a film that's went straight to streaming.
Like, yeah, Martin Scorsese. Patty Jenkins, you're literally kind of mocking a Martin Scorsese film. Yeah. Like
they all want to mark. They all want to mock Scorsese at this point. They're like,
well,
what? Yeah, he made all the comments about combo movies. They're always like, oh, I don't know about him.
Like, dude. But yeah, no, I comment on that post earlier, and I put like because the picture that they used was Gal in that last sequence or whatever, where it was like. You know, winter and there's lights and all that. And I was like, dude, I'm not sure, but this reminds me of something you would see on Hallmark.
Yeah.
Totally. Yeah. No, it looked like shit. When I watched it, I was like, ooh, this is cringy. Okay. I was actually just trying to get through it. When I was watching that scene,
he's like,
I was
like, "Remember me?
Come on, okay. Maybe you'll get better here." And it had parts where it was good. But
true, Gavin. This is very true.
He's like, "You look familiar. Were exactly, you the lady Gavin. That raped me?"
That's exactly right. It's a total backhanded comment to anyone working on any kind of production.
Set
on a streaming service.
Even the dude that all he does is fucking sweep the floor after they get done filming on a set. That dude, you talk
sweep the leg.
You know what I mean? You talk
sweep the leg.
You worked on that movie? Yeah,
like not even Denis Villeneuve has said something so, you know,
yeah,
off like that. Like, you know, I know he feels very like strongly about Dune being a dual release, but at the same time, it's like, look at the climate. Yeah,
he's another one yeah. that you like. If he said something like this, you probably say, okay, Dennis, chill. But also wouldn't be as you know what I mean? Like, I don't think he would ever come off as saying they're fake.
Yeah,
right. Movies, the streamer was a fake. Oh, dude.
Like, look at the little.
It's not a real movie.
That video Zach did yesterday or the day before with showing off the rear camera. Like David Fincher, like both of them have movies on Netflix. It's like, really? Like you've worked, you know, Zack Snyder personally. So I don't understand why you would say something like that in light of two of his films this year releasing on a streaming service. And then
his next few will also release.
Right.
So yeah.
Yeah.
Also, that camera fired, dude, $25,000, I think.
What, the red camera?
The red camera. I think it's like 24 G's.
I'm going to fall over and die now because I want that camera, but that's like my whole student loan in one go.
Yeah, so that's me. Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
So her comments that I guess we all in agreement that's.
It was uncouth. It wasn't needed. It wasn't required. It was just, you know, she's just trying to.
It was ill-advised.
Ill-advised.
Yeah. And I understand if she's
on a panel for CinemaCon, I think. But you're right. Ill-advised. Sorry, Anthony. I had to mute
you. No, you're good. You're good. But like, even if it's like a thing where like, even if Nolan feels the same way, which I doubt he does because he's
Christopher Nolan.
He's a pro-creator, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, he would never call somebody's material fake. I don't even think, even if he thought it and would not say it, I don't even think he thinks it. So, like, and you know what? Patty might not even think that. She might not even think that it's fake, but maybe the way it came out, maybe her delivery of it or whatever. But, yeah, ill-advised and, yo, Patty, relax.
Poor. Relax. Very, very, very poor. Poor choice of words.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very poor choice of words. Very, very poor choice of words.
Also, something else that dropped today, and I don't know if you guys are excited about this as I am, is Red Notice that finally got a trailer for it.
I haven't seen the trailer.
I haven't seen the trailer either.
Oh, well, y'all about to do a live reaction because I'm about
Let's do it.
Yes. I also saw that Accountant 2 got announced with
yes.
We're gonna hit that up in a
little bit. Yeah. You're jumping the gun.
Don't show up here and derail the show. Just get him out of here.
I apologize for my co-host.
You're good.
We have Ryan Rivera backstage.
You mean my other co-host?
Yeah, your other co-host.
Well, I'm his co-host. I'm technically his co-host. It's no big deal.
he's gonna be
by the way, with the fishes.
When we do talk about the Accountant, if you don't like the first one, what's good with you for real though? The first one is fine.
If you don't like the first one, then I'm sorry. Like, you're not American.
That movie,
you're not American.
That movie is absolute cinema at its finest. Like, totally am. I love it.
Red Notice, if you don't know what it is a movie starring The Rock, Gal Gadot, Ryan Reynolds. It's like an international, global fucking action thriller.
This is a sequel one more to Red, right?
Gal Gadot, right? Wonder Woman?
Yeah.
It's not cinema.
Is this a sequel type movie? Unless
it's my movie.
But it's on Netflix. It's got to be fake.
Yeah. It's got to be. This is a fake movie.
No! That even makes it worse. Her saying that statement, knowing that her
is in a
fake streaming movie.
Yeah. This is a fake movie. All right, let's see it.
Fake news.
Special Agent John Hartley, FBI.
Yep.
I've been tracking your scores for a while now. Every city, every heist. Now that you've been tagged with red notices, you've become the world's most wanted criminals. And I'm the only one who can bring you in.
Where'd you get that jacket? It's a statement piece. Somewhere there's a very nude cow whispering.
Looking for something specific or just browsing?
You're under arrest.
Oh my God. Read the room.
Keep the secret. You want to arrest me? So loud a voice making noise.
Rest me.
I just want the egg.
Dang.
Damn.
We'll help you.
Teamwork. Live and direct, you know we get there.
Team. It feels weird in my mouth.
Hello, boys. How's it going with your partner in crime?
We're work wives.
We're not work wives.
We're sister wives.
We're not any kind of wives.
We both know that this whole thing is going to end with you in handcuffs.
That Babe in the Woods act.
Yep. Yeah.
That's straight up that scene.
Yes. Oh, yeah. 100%.
Agent John Hartley.
All right. I'm going to watch that.
That's cool.
Oh, yeah. I'm very much looking forward.
Looking forward to that.
Yeah.
Add that to the list right quick.
Yeah.
Ryan Reynolds being Ryan Reynolds. And that's
I was like, there's Deadpool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Guy.
That's why I haven't seen Free Guy, but that's it, the Free Guy's a departure from what we've seen from him in his last few movies. So like why
Free Guy is so freaking good.
Yeah,
good to know. I'll have to watch it.
Yeah, I saw it twice in theaters.
It's a departure from
so you know it's good.
I'm seeing Shang-Chi this weekend.
So. Me too. I
also want to see Shang-Chi.
Was it me or did
Ryan Reynolds look like kind of small and he looked old?
He looked smaller, yeah.
He did. Yeah, he looked smaller and older.
Hell older, yeah.
Yeah, like, everyone else looked like they're in prime shape. And he's just like,
did Ryan just call Ryan Reynolds a grandpa?
Yep.
He might have.
He looked like a grandpa.
That's a little hypocritical, wouldn't you say?
No, but I'm looking forward to it. I thought it was good. It's a Netflix action movie, which I've been pretty satisfied with. What was the one with Chris Hemsworth? Extraction.
Yeah.
Yes.
That one was actually really well done.
Yeah.
Dude, that chase scene, that one shot.
Give me
holy
some more.
Crap! Yeah, the freaking director sitting on the hood of a car in a chase scene, dude. That's dedication. Holy crap!
Yeah, no, it was good. And the other Ryan Reynolds Netflix film was not that bad either.
Six Underground, I think.
Yeah, Six Underground. Yes.
Oh, I keep meaning to watch that.
That's Bay, isn't it? Hmm? Michael Bay, isn't that Michael?
Well, I thought you were calling him a Bay, like Bay.
Yeah,
He's a Bay.
He's a total Bay.
He's a Bay.
Obviously, that scene and people have been pointing it out all day. I don't think that they. I think that's a nod to good Sir Zach because that is direct. Like, well, I'm sure you guys have seen it online today too, where people have been putting it up there. The comparisons between the two scenes. Yes, they do. They are exactly the same thing, pretty much except for the dialogue. So, yeah looking forward to that. November 12th, so it's not that far away. This is Netflix's most expensive movie they've ever made, period.
And it's Gal Gadot as a villain.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right.
Which is something we haven't seen yet. So
And she's like one of those like good guy villains where she's a bad guy, but yet like she's probably gonna end up like being on their side at the end. Who knows?
She also looks incredible. So
Well,
I mean that's Ryan Reynolds. Gal Gadot.
Well, they all look like they're like They're doing what they do best. So,
yeah, no, that's somebody said that everyone doing what they can do perfectly. Yes.
Well said. Yeah. Yes. Neil.
It's good to finally see a trailer from this movie considering they had to stop filming for the pandemic and they finished it still pretty much like last year. So
they really
haven't given us anything, which is like movies are trending in that direction. It seems like where they're giving you like, they're not giving you trailers until like close to the movie's about to release.
Which I agree with because if you put out a trailer too far in advance, you have the hype and the energy for it. Then it fades. And when it finally comes out, it's like, meh. But But if you put out a trailer like a couple weeks or like a month or two before it comes out, and it comes out what feels like in a very short amount of time, that mm-hmm. hype's still there to a certain extent. It's still in your mind.
Yeah.
Fresh.
Yeah. And it says that Red Notice is definitely going to see. Yes. All the actors in this movie are A-listers, not dying. None of them.
None of them.
Yeah.
If someone dies in this movie, I'll be genuinely surprised.
Yes. Yeah. And also probably won't catch Gal. And she escapes at the last second and
leads to the sequel.
Or he does catch her and then he has to use her in the sequel to help him find some other person.
Boom. Her boss.
It's the next Fast and Furious franchise.
That's kind of what it looks like.
Please be smarter than that, though.
Please be
more intelligent than that.
It looked like Fast and Furious meets a little bit of
Bad Boys.
A little bit of Bad Boys. I could see that. Maybe a little bit of Mission Impossible with a hint.
But I do hope they touch up that bull ring scene that we saw in the trailer.
Oh, dude, yeah.
Yeah.
Because the green screen, that was very evident.
Yo, it was bad. Let me find it.
Yeah, because I saw that and I was like, whoa.
Relax.
That's a digital environment. That's not real. Yeah.
Yeah, it's not real.
I saw this on my phone this morning and I was like, wait.
Yeah, I was like, that's really
especially the shot with Dwayne Johnson. Like that shot right there.
With the bull foot, yeah. Oh yeah.
It's
like you can clearly tell the hoof is not
Just behind Dwayne Johnson right there, like the lighting of the arena doesn't match the lighting that's on Dwayne Johnson. Mm-hmm. Like it's doesn't quite work there. Yeah.
There's probably standing in a green screen.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah. He's in Spain.
He's in Spain. They filled the entire Coliseum because it's The Rock.
Yeah. They all came out. They're like, they don't care about anything. They just want to see a glimpse of The Rock.
They want to see a glimpse,
You know what's interesting is Ryan Reynolds shared this trailer on his YouTube channel. It has twice the views that Netflix is.
Oh, wow.
Damn.
Oh, yeah,
he's audience puller.
Yeah, that's fucking crazy.
Again, utilizing social media for advertising instead of spending tons and tons of money to do so. It just makes sense.
And Marvel sitting there twiddling their thumbs like, oh, what are we going to do with Deadpool? It's like, he's right there. Go for it.
Yeah.
They said 3 might shoot next year. So fingers crossed.
Nice.
And indeed.
So something else that dropped besides the trailer, like we're all looking forward to the movie. I'm sure. I mean, it's Netflix. We all have Netflix. We're going to watch it. And
yeah.
You know, do plenty of shows talking about what is this? Hold up. Well, where's my mouse? Okay, here we go. This is Dawson 84 CGI is worse than that.
Wow, he's saying more than 84.
I was like, wait a minute, Dawson has there's a movie called Dawson that's CG.
There's a movie, called Dawson 84.
Yeah, it's back when I was negative 13 years old.
It's Dawson with a lasso.
Yeah.
It's me in the premortal realm.
So Zach dropped this. I didn't see it last night when he dropped it. I guess he dropped it like sometime yesterday evening or night. I saw it this morning when I got up. But he dropped this thing on Vero where he says, and this is, it's kind of a thing for us fans. You know what I mean? Like I read it and I was like, oh shit, that's fire. He's just like, in 6 days, you get a chance to hold in your hands this thing that is so much more than a movie. It's impossible. It's an impossible miracle that all of you carefully willed into existence. A thing I happily tore my heart out to give you, and now it's yours. So if you guys don't know what we're talking about, on Tuesday, Zack Snyder's Justice League officially releases in the United States on physical media. And it's fire. Let's fucking go. What he's saying here is kind of a thing where just like, it's kind of the same feeling, like, you know what I mean? Like I wasn't one of the people who ordered one of the overseas copies or whatever. I wanted to wait to get this one. So, and now it's coming. I ordered a couple different ones. I wanted a steel book and then there was another one. Phil, I'm gonna start with you, man. Your thoughts on like, actually, like you're going to be holding that shit after the fight. In like less than a week.
You know, I always thought to myself after walking out of that movie, even knowing like that wasn't quite a Zack Snyder film, and then walking and going through the experience and then finding the community, you know, early last year, and now like knowing that everything that happened paid off, and knowing that it was, it's going to be a reality, like, you know, a physical reality. That's more impressive. Cause for the longest time I thought it was, you know, if they were to do it, and I kind of imagined that they would, because like it was a pretty tall order and the way things went down, mm-hmm. it was kind of a black eye for the studio, no matter what way they tried to talk about it. So
yeah,
it was being in their best interest to probably finish it and release it. And I'm glad that they did, even though they're still being kind of shitty about it, but
they're being real shitty about it.
Right. But even still, be all that said, like the fact that this man took time to come back to this project after everything that he went through is nothing short of inspiring. And it is absolutely just, it warms my heart to know that he cares that much and that he gave up practically everything to do this project, this one last, his last hurrah in the DC universe for the time being. And it's just like, this movie has a really special place in my heart, because I always thought, and I knew in my heart, that if his film ever got released, it would absolutely be received better than not only his prior two entries in the DC universe, but also the theatrical cut. No question about it.
Sure. Yeah.
And to actually have it in my hands, it's not, it's going to feel like love.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the biggest thing for me, I know, is that like, it's, they have a physical copy of it. And now it's like, I have something that they cannot take away from me now.
Yeah.
Like they can't just like take it off HBO Max. And I can never see it again. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, you have a physical copy, that's your copy, and that's the one that you purchased, and that's the one you fought for to be able to have the right or ability to purchase a copy of it. And it's pretty remarkable when you look at the whole thing and how it all played out. I mean, if they just would have let him finish his movie and do it the way he wanted to do it, it would have turned out so much better than what they had, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, it's so fascinating, because, you know, if this never happened, we would have got, you know, probably the 2:14 cut, which would have had Stephen Neeson in the movie. It would have had a lot of other things, that a lot more jokes, a lot of that stuff.
Yeah,
it would have been a compromise cut, but that would have been what we got. So now we got. But see, this is what's incredible about this movie, and you know, I know people, you know, don't always think about this, but what's incredible is that we watched a 4-hour movie. And it's, in my opinion, at least, okay, I think that it's a freaking masterpiece.
Yeah.
I love that movie. It's just, it's such a good movie. But you're watching a movie that is put together based on principal photography. It wasn't like he went back and did, you know, reshoots on certain shots or pickups or whatnot. No, he shot them. He did principal photography, and that's it. Like most movies, you know, they do additional photography or they do reshoots on certain scenes, especially when you're using a lot of special effects and these big, you know, action pieces. You know, hey, let's go back and shoot this scene because that one didn't come out right, or we wanted to add this part into it. No, I mean, he literally had to shoot it, and then they were just like, look, here's the film, that here's everything you shot, you know, this is all you get to work with. And it's pretty remarkable, you know, what actually turned, you know, what they were actually able to produce.
Especially when it comes to CGI, the fact they had less than a year to give us the Steppenwolf and Darkseid that we got, like, oh my gosh.
On top of the additional photography, 5 minutes towards the end with everything, with everyone.
Yeah, I mean, all the talent that went into making them, you know, a reality. Yeah, hell yeah. Because, I mean, it takes a long time to animate.
Yeah,
but, you know, I've said it before, but like, to me, it really irritates me, the fact that I really wish that the Zack Snyder Justice League would have been released on a weekly basis in episodic form. I love seeing it as a movie, but if it was in episodic form, this thing would have been so much bigger. It was already huge and already a huge success, but think about how much bigger it would have been if it was a week-by-week release.
Mm.
The anticipation, the hype every single week, it would have been tremendous. I mean, we saw how big Game of Thrones got. I mean, Dawson hasn't watched it, but still... we've seen how huge game. I mean, Anthony, you know what I'm talking about. Game of Thrones every Sunday was like gigantic.
Yeah.
And so it would have been like that. So it's a shame that it didn't happen that way.
I also think that that last line, real quick in there, that let me find a better one so you can read it better. Here we go. This is a thing I happily tore my heart out to give you. Is for me, my interpretation of that is, the only reason we got like you were just talking about Andre, if we had gotten the if they hadn't messed with him at all and he released his movie, his original thing, it wouldn't have been what we got earlier this year. It would have been still a compromised movie. And I think, you know, the only reason that we got what we got this year is because of the passing of his daughter. So it's like a thing where, like, me personally would happily live with the 2017 Justice League if Zack still had his daughter. Period. Like, that's not a thing. You know what I mean? That's not a
hard thing. Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
But what I'm saying is, what this line, a thing I happily told my is he knows that the only reason that he was able to give this to us is because of that thing. So and so that's how I interpreted that. That's why when I read it earlier today, when I saw it this morning, dude, I was like, oh shit, man. You know, and but he said he happily tore out his heart to give it to us because we fought so hard for him to be able to put this out there. And for me personally, to just have it, and like Andre said, they can't take this, they'll never be able to take that from me. You know what I mean? Like, I'll be able to throw this shit on in 6 years, I'll be able to throw that in my Blu-ray player and watch it and just be like, yo, because who knows how dumb they are. They could take it off HBO Max like anytime because they're
that petty.
And that's and that's why, like, I'm so, like, again, with the statement, it's just amazing the fact that he dedicates so much to his fans. And it's just like, you know how seriously it takes that fan interaction. Mm-hmm. And again, like, being able to have it in your hands, like, again, getting the box set, having Man of Steel, BVS Ultimate Edition remastered version, apparently, and Zack Snyder's Justice League all in one box set. My favorite trilogy ever, right? All in one place and able to have it in my hands. And to, again, like you said, Warner Bros. Is petty enough to where they could take it off of HBO Max. They definitely could eventually.
Yeah.
And that would piss off a lot of people. But like you guys said, they can't take that away from me if I have it. And I'm at the point where, like, if it weren't for Raised by Wolves, all I need to do is order the box set of Friends from wherever, and then I wouldn't need HBO Max anymore.
You're so whack.
Friends. I mean, yeah. I mean, I watch Friends and DC stuff on HBO Max.
Awesome. That's awesome. Friends is funny. But no, it's true. I mean, you know, the things that are on there. I mean, unless they really start to up their content, I'm like, I don't know how much longer I'm going to keep my subscription once I get my copy of Zack Snyder's Justice League. It's kind of like, you know, they're not. The hope for me was that they would continue on with other projects that were related to this movie, and it seems like they're not going to, at least at this point. They haven't announced anything.
Sure, yeah.
And so it's kind of like, okay, so... But then, you know, there are projects, you know, like Phil was saying about, you know, the Black Canary project, and, you know, there's Batgirl coming out pretty soon.
I get what you're saying. I absolutely get what you're saying. They're like, the fact that they're not moving forward with any, like, kind of productions that would specifically cater to that storyline, they're not interested in, but they are still trying to keep things in the world that he did create, which will make a lot of people happy. It might not make some all the way happy, but you know, like I mentioned, Black Canary, I'm really looking forward to, because I do like Journey Smollett-Bell in the role. I think she's honestly been the best one we've had, all live action ones considered, including on TV. So, like, you know, I was happily, like, I remember last year there was that cry for HBO Black Canary HBO series on HBO Max, and now that, like, they're doing a full-fledged movie about it, it's like, cool, hopefully it does happen.
But that was an easier decision for them to make that, because they're like, oh well, that happened post Snyder, so that's, you know, that's still considered us. I don't think Katsuka, that's still considered us. So, you know what, they want that, let's give it to them.
Let's
They want the Snyder. We don't want to do that. Let's go Black Canary. Yes,
we're here to please the fans.
Yeah.
Well, the only drawback, or the only problem, is that it's only going to be released on Blu-ray. So if there's another,
what are you talking about?
Okay. So I got to slow it down for Andre, because he's having.
I'm talking about the post that he just brought up.
No, I'm talking about the Blu-ray, and I'm talking about Zack Snyder's Justice League coming out that everybody's going to be getting. Mm-hmm. Not talking about, you know, what's going on in the comment section. We'll get to that in a minute, but I just wanted to weigh in real quick because, you know, every other Warner Brothers venture, every time there's an advance in technology, they always release a newer copy that has, you know, enhanced features or whatever. Yeah. So like if you were to get Zack Snyder's Justice League, like way back when it was VHS, they're not going to continue to like make or put that into production. I think this is going to be the only time that you're going to get it on 4K Blu-ray. When they go to 8K, you know, and let's say they go to a different player, you know, we're not going to have this particular movie. You know, we can only enjoy it with this, you know, current resolution. Technology that we have. Yeah, this current resolution that they're releasing it in. So that's the only problem that I see moving forward as technology advances, and it always does, and it's always, you know, it's rapid. It seems like as years, you know, creep on, it, you know, these things, you know, get released like, oh, shit, 8K TVs. People have 8K TVs now. Yep. And, you know, and so as things progress, this is one thing that's going to be left in the dust. And that's unfortunate because they're not gonna reproduce 8K versions and all that because they don't care about it. The only way that they would do it is if they were to, after the Zaslav the Magnificent comes in and says, you know what, I adapt the magician. Yeah. I adopt this version and we want to continue off of this one as well. Like this is also canon for you guys. This is also part of it. Then they would, you know, advance the, you know, copies and give you better resolution or you know, compatible versions of the film or whatever. But yeah, I mean, that's, you know, as time progresses, this is one movie that's not going to progress like the other one. Like you're going to get a Batman and Robin, you know, 8K version before you get a Zack Snyder.
Please, no.
Okay. Hold on. See, I think you're getting way ahead of yourself because like, they've already been updated versions of Batman and Robin since that has come out initially on VHS.
But
that's an awful movie. Everybody knows it's an awful movie.
No, it's
and Zack Snyder's Justice League is actually very, very quality. So like, regardless of how spiteful they are and how they still want to make money, that's why they're putting out these 4Ks and Blu-rays in the first place.
They're not
like,
going to continue to make money.
Why wouldn't they? There's terrible movies that get that all the time.
I'm sorry, Dawson. They're just I cannot see in a world of fucking Warner Brothers being the way that they are that they would continue to keep trying to release this particular movie that they didn't want to.
You know why they would? Because they want to keep the Snyderverse fans intrigued. They'll say, "Hey, we're re-releasing the movie that you guys like." They're trying to cater and keep those fans without actually pandering to them with giving us the story. That's the one they would be able to do it and still make money.
I think Justice League would be, you know, what they would retool and issue new, you know, better, higher quality versions of before Zack Snyder's Justice League. They're cutting off their hand to spite their face already. They don't.
Yeah, but the continuation of the story. But as far as like releases of DVDs, like that's just simply re-releasing a movie. They don't have to put any real effort into that besides just simply producing it and getting it out there. Like that's not hiring actors. It's not getting people back aboard. It's like every other movie in their dog gets re-released in a newer format with each release a different player. Why would Zack Snyder's Justice League be any different just because of some stupid spite? It's not like they're rehiring Zack Snyder.
It's because of that. It's because of stupid spite.
I don't think they want to put it out. They're still a company at the end.
They're that stupid. From what I've seen, they are that stupid.
I would say that they probably are that stupid.
And Frank makes a good point.
Frank's got a good point.
Yeah. He's still yes.
Yeah, because Emmerich's the main.
But it's not Emmerich only. It's not like Emmerich is the only one, and everybody else is like, no, let's do this. I mean, there's
that's
other.
WB
Emmerich has a lot of power.
He's just the main voice. You know,
he's the guy behind the scenes that like basically tells people like, hey, this is not what we're doing, and everybody's just kind of falling in line because he has a lot of power and he's been in the industry for a long time. So if
he's
gone,
not going anywhere. I don't think he's going anywhere.
He's gone, though. His contract's up at the end of next year.
The same thing has been said about Kathleen Kennedy. And where's that bitch? She's still in the same position. Her contract was up this year. They're like, oh, no, she's leaving. She's out of the. Oh, she's.
There's a civil war.
There's a civil war behind. Yeah. So she's not going anywhere.
Apparently, Doomcock is reliable now.
No, he's not reliable. That's what we're saying.
He's not reliable because he said she was going. She isn't going.
Well, the point is, the story of Kathleen Kennedy and Toby Emmerich is very, very different. People in Warner Brothers are very aware of how bad Toby Emmerich is, according to Rob Meyer Burnett, who has insiders inside of Warner Brothers. They know he's created a culture in Warner Brothers that is toxic and is not able to produce great quality content. Whereas with Kathleen Kennedy, she's been there since the original trilogy, from what I understand.
Yeah, she's not an asshole. Her movie is just not being successful.
Yeah. John Favreau has had nothing but nice things to say about Kathleen Kennedy. Anyone who talks about Toby Emmerich, they don't exactly have the best things to say. And then you see that guy in interviews, he just looks slimy. He just looks so disgusted with what he's about to say. He has no care. He just doesn't give a shit. He's the most piss poor chairman they've ever had. And that's the reason why the content is suffering the way it is because of his piss poor management.
Now,
and,
I mean, I want them to continue to make copies as technology progresses? Yes, of course.
Absolutely.
I just at the current state and the current mindset that they're at, I think they'll just let that collect dust.
Well, only time will tell. I mean, we don't know.
So you're saying we won't get an updated version 10 or 15 years from now. There's no way.
That's why you got to buy your copy when it comes out.
It just depends. I would lean towards probably not, I would hope that.
Listen to me now.
I would hope that they. I hope by then that they change their paradigm, that their mindset, to have different executives that are younger, that might be like, "Yo, I like that stuff."
All right. So what I was gonna say was that I think he's right to a certain extent. It will get delayed a little bit as far as those new copies come. But also, I think the movie looks so good now that I don't care if 8K comes out and they don't advance it immediately. Because the movie looks fire. And
I don't even see an 8K. Look, so when I'm watching on TV, I'm like, honestly,
you got to imagine there's also a lot of investors who put a lot of stock into physical media.
If you bounce him, he'll leave. And he'll come back.
I mean, dude, I've been trying to talk for 10 minutes. All right. But anyway, like I was saying, I think it looks so good now. Okay. If they don't immediately advance it to 8K, fine. Because it still looks tremendous.
The worst they'll do is delay it. That's the worst they'll do.
Yeah. If they delay it, but still, it's not like the comparison he was making was, it's not like the movie looks like a VHS copy and 8K's out here thriving.
Yeah.
And we're just still looking at like, wait a minute, what? Now the movie still is going to be, the quality is going to be good enough to take. So,
but like my point is that like, Superman, The Quest for Peace, and Batman and Robin have had remasters released.
Yeah, right? They have.
And those two are awful. They're god awful. And everybody knows that.
So before the show, oh, he's back. Hey! It's a zebra.
Oh, here, I'll pull a Dawson.
All right.
Yeah. He never swears. He just gives his middle finger all the time.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, just earlier, before the show, I was watching the third act of Zack Snyder's Justice League. And then for some stupid reason, I was like, I watched the part of the third act from Joss's. Like, I couldn't even get through it. I was like, God, this is so bad. Because I was like, I wanted to see the comparison again. And it's just so horrible.
Why did you watch that?
Because like, I was on YouTube. How did you torture yourself like that?
Do you need a hug?
Because it was a suggested video. I was like, oh, no, let me see this one.
And you're like, oh, God. Okay. And
as soon as it got to the Russian family, I turned it off. I was like, oh, this is dumb.
He's like, I guess the algorithm.
I was like, I cannot continue on with this. It's so bad.
Oh man.
What up, sickness? I don't have to drive.
What's up, sickness?
Hello, sickness. Oh,
yeah, what up, what up, what up?
What's up?
It's ooh-wah. It's a bad version. I can't do it.
Very bad version. It's all right though.
I don't know if there's a 4K of Donner's Cut.
Is 8K, is that really coming out?
Yeah.
Yes.
8K is a thing. Yeah. 8K is indeed a thing. Yeah.
Oh, it's a thing. Okay.
Yeah.
It's a good thing I just got a 4K TV and it's about to become obsolete.
I hope they don't do all the movies though.
They will. I mean, that's what they do. Okay, so from DVD to Blu-ray, 4K, to HD Ultra or whatever.
This movie.
They continue to release these things in more formats, or they'll have more extras or whatever.
I gotta get the new one.
It's residual. They just keep getting money, and that's how they can pay their talent. Well, is through
residual checks.
Physical media is a dying industry. I mean, there's not a lot of purchases being done through physical media besides the ones that are nostalgic, or it's a brand new movie that everybody wants, such as Zack Snyder's Justice League.
Yeah.
When Infinity
like
War came out, I bought it on Blu-ray, and when Endgame came out, I bought it. There's certain movies I'm going to buy. Star Wars.
Just got this today. Mortal Kombat, nice. Battle of the Realm, Legends of Battle of the Realm.
Oh, I thought that was the newest one. I was like,
Put it up again.
Nice.
Nice.
Very nice.
So, other than that, like your non-action, non, you know, just your regular movies, draw, you know, they're not going to
sell. You're not going to find the Notebook in 8K.
No.
Right.
There's no need exactly. for it, really. Yeah. And that's just the way of movies these days.
I can't wait for 48K. Okay, relax. Yeah. That's like oh, us. No, that's no. like somebody. That's that definition would be better than looking at someone in real life.
I want to watch it on the Oculus where I would like say I'm actually there.
In the next 5 years, we're probably going to get closer, like maybe 8 to 16K, maybe something like that.
Goodness gracious.
I was just saying that movie. I mean,
there we go.
16K is there. As well, that's just, you know, 8K is just the next stepping stone. So right. yeah,
as math goes, yes.
Yeah, usually when you're multiplying, that's how it goes.
Resolution, okay. speak. Yes, basically.
There you go.
That's the same.
What's the resolution if we're multiplying, Dawson?
Huh? You just said it. 8 and 16K. We just said it.
But what's the resolution?
What? I don't. The I resolution. Don't care. I don't okay. care.
I don't know what the resolution is.
It would be. Shit, I'm trying to think about it right now because it goes.
What is it? 2400?
1080. It'd be somewhere in that. It'd probably be like actually.
I know is that it goes 1280 by 720, and then it goes 1920 by 1080, and after that it goes 4K.
Right.
And that's it is, as far as it goes for me. But yeah. Moving along now.
Yes, moving on.
Moving so, right along.
I'm not sure. We'll talk about this a bit. Did everybody see the fourth episode of What If?
Woo! Yeah, I did.
Okay.
Andre's excited.
Good Lord, it was so good.
Yo, the fourth episode of the show was an absolute.
I need to watch it again.
Bang. But, I watched it. This is the first time I watched an episode of the show twice. An absolute fucking banger. Dude, the animation and the spoilers, just real quick. I mean, we're not going to go too deep in, but the animation and the fight between the two Doctor Stranges, absolute fucking get
the
out
whole
of here.
Thing. The whole thing was badass. I enjoyed the entire story, and I watched this like just after midnight, and I went to see it, and I was watching it at home, and I remember thinking, I was like, okay, I hope this doesn't get boring because I'm already kind of tired. No, I was engaged the entire time. I was like, dude, this show is badass. This is a great episode.
The first half of the episode was absolutely a retread, though, of The Time Machine, which, I mean, it really was, because if you guys watch The Time Machine, the guy loses his girl. He tries to go back in time multiple times, and she dies every single time. And so I was sitting there watching the episode, and I love the episode. It's a great episode. But I sat there thinking, I've seen this before. I have watched this somewhere. Pierce? What was that? Yeah, Guy Pearce. Yeah.
Okay.
Great movie.
This is honestly the one, to Anthony's point, like I really, thinking about it, like this is the first one that makes me go, I want to watch it again. And it's because the only thing I can think of that really makes me go, huh, that doesn't really like kind of sit well with me was the Ancient One's kind of understanding of like, oh, I split this timeline into two. It's like, what?
That one was cool though.
It was cool. But like, you know, me being the dork, I'm just like trying to make sense of it because that's the kind of person I am. Like I have to know. Like I have to know how that makes sense because when it's presented to me, I'm just like, wait a minute, what? So I have to watch it again to try and really understand how or why like she was able to, you know, have in a multiverse, like this single timeline is now split into two. I'm like, ooh, I want to know how that happens.
And I also like the fact that this episode addressed an issue that I felt like I was going to have with the show, because the entire time, the first three episodes, you see the Watcher and you feel like, oh, he's just simply going to be excuse for a narrator, right? That's basically all it's going to be. He's just going to watch. But this episode, he is much more involved. Dr. Strange actually hears him and sees him. I was like, okay, he's actually an integral character that I really should care about instead of just simply being an excuse for someone to narrate what is happening on screen.
Yes.
Yeah, I love how he interacted with him. You know, he was like, you know, he called him out in a sense. He was like, no, I cannot interfere. Spoiler alert, if you haven't seen it yet, go watch it after the show. It's a fire episode. It's a very... There's a lots of layers to the episode. It felt like I was watching like a shortened movie. It was so good. I really, really enjoyed what they did, and I really feel like every week it's gotten better and better and better. Mm-hmm. And then they even announced too that in season two of What If,
that they're going to have a Black Widow episode too, which is kind of cool.
And what I love, you just pointed out that it felt like a movie pretty much. I love the fact that this episode wasn't a slightly different retread of another MCU movie, because it allowed it to explore different things in a time frame that matched the length of the episode. It felt like a complete episode that wasn't rushed. It felt like the story had a little bit of room to breathe and be able to expand on some things. Whereas compare that to the first episode of What If with Captain Carter, how it was a rushed version of Captain America, the First Avenger. Yeah. This one felt like a cohesive story that had its own amount of time to work things out.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the longest episode I think thus far. Mm-hmm. There's nothing. I can't find anything that I didn't like about this episode. Like, I was watching and I was like, wait a minute. Yo, dude, this is absolute. And also the voice acting in this.
So it was great.
Rachel McAdams was even better than Benedict Cumberbatch. Like, she was fire, dude. Like, as it played, what's the girl's name?
Christine Palmer.
Christine, yeah.
Did she actually do the voice too?
Yes.
Yeah.
She's
going to be back for Multiverse of Madness.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Okay.
She did the voice. And I was just like, yo, she was really, really good. And so was Benedict. But dude, how dark the show it's getting progressively dark. And like you were saying, Dawson, while they started off with this series, like,
well, it can't get too dark, otherwise Dawson can't watch.
Really? Really?
I had to go there. Go ahead.
While the first episode started off as literally being pretty much a retread of the first Avenger, just changing the roles and changing a few lines here and there, now it's moved to where it's like the last one, the one with the especially the T'Challa episode, was just a totally, it wasn't the rehash of Guardians of the Galaxy. In other words.
Right.
No, yeah, you know, exactly.
And with this one, when they fought, man.
You know, I really liked that this episode establishes like everything that's happened with Doctor Strange, at least as far as the first film is concerned, absolutely happened. But the twist of it is, you know, Christine Palmer is the one that dies. He doesn't lose his hands.
Yeah.
That sucks, because like, you know, it really does set up for like a very like downfall-ish episode. But again, it's like about one of my favorite characters in the MCU. Doctor Strange is my favorite film, so that might also probably have like a bit of an influence as to why I really like this episode as well, probably to everyone's point here. I don't know how you guys feel about that film in particular.
Yeah, I like it.
Doctor Strange is a good movie.
I enjoyed it quite a bit.
I actually really enjoy what's his friend's name?
Wong? Is it
Wong? Yeah. And of course, they brought the actor back to do the voice, and
and
everything he's been in so far. And when it comes to the MCU, he always does a great job and staying in character and being consistent with his character. Mm-hmm. And it's not like in What If, the second episode, what's his face? You know, was like, oh, it's Star-Lord. You know, he was really.
Oh yeah, Jimon Hausu,
but. Yeah. But Chang, you know, the other guy has always just been even keel, and he's funny, yet he's knowledgeable, and I really enjoy him.
And he's not over the top when he is funny, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I like how at the end he's like, you should probably join me before you do something, you know,
really stupid,
stupid, you know. But it's almost like he knew, like, no matter what I say, you're either gonna do it or you're not.
So after seeing
decisions go.
After seeing like a Doctor Strange versus Doctor Strange, is anyone hoping to kind of maybe see that in Multiverse of Madness if it might happen?
In my opinion, I think that we will definitely run into that.
That shit was that's with this series thus far. That's it, the it best animation.
Come,
I've
it will come
seen.
Full circle.
Yeah,
I firmly believe that this story will in some way be connected to the Multiverse of Madness. If not, I think they're going to follow up with it on another season, but I feel like this movie is going to, this story is going to connect in some way or form to the movie that's coming out. Maybe an aspect of it, maybe something, an appearance, but
something just occurred to me. Agent Carter, Captain Carter, episode one, and this episode both featured the same tentacle monster.
Yep.
Yes.
And yes. I have reason to believe that's Shuma Garoth. I think it's Shuma Garoth.
Mm. Mm.
Yes.
Now, for those like myself who aren't informed on the more mystical parts of Marvel, who is that?
Shuma Garoth is most certainly a possibility. Like, I'm just going to give you guys a picture of Shuma Garoth right now.
Yeah, give us that.
Do it.
It's pretty. Shima Garoth is like a. It's.
Yeah.
I don't know how to explain it.
It would.
Big, big eyeball.
Yeah.
And I always. I've been a big like. I mean, we all have, but like I've talked about this, the animation in this series. Like, even though I don't think they've technically improved it, I think that they've just every episode it seems to get better with when they've made all the episodes at the same time. So there's not like a, you know what I mean? It probably is not improving. It just looks better every episode. Maybe they designed it that way. Here's a Phil's picture. Okay.
Oh, okay. Right.
This is Shuma Garoth. Shuma Garoth is, and more often than not, I think associated with Doctor Strange. You see that this character pop up with that realm of the Marvel corner. But yeah, those green tentacles, I knew I saw them before. And then I started thinking, I was like, wait a minute, Shuma Garoth.
Yeah, he's associated with Doctor Strange. He's, he's in the Doctor Strange comics.
Yeah.
That's who Red Skull tried to bring into...
Yeah, in the Ken Carter episode.
Yeah.
So interesting. I'm curious to see if that actually ties in sometime later on. That'd be really, really interesting. Because he didn't kill the creature. He just simply took its tentacles and absorbed that.
Him. Yeah.
Yo, not only that. That was also
you're right. He sliced the tentacles and he absorbed that. That's right.
Yeah. Now, who's also directing Doctor Strange into Multiverse of Madness and who loves using giant monsters in creepy horror fashion?
Sam Raimi.
Sam Raimi.
That would make a lot of sense, actually. Now you mentioned that.
Yeah. I also didn't realize, like, I saw the little, like, time lapse thing.
Mm-hmm.
But I was like, I didn't know it was centuries, though, dude. That shit was crazy. Like,
Oh, where he goes into the Library of Cagliostro? Oh, man.
Yeah, that he's just absorbing so much, and then all this, you see the stuff changing outside. Mm-hmm. But like,
another reference to the time machine.
Yep. Yes. And then until I saw the guy was like
Obeng. I think the character's name is.
He's just like, I was like, what's going on? I said, like, oh shit. He's like centuries. I was like, damn, dude.
Yeah, I like that quite a bit. It made it to where like it showed just how far he had gone in his obsession to get what he had lost.
Yeah.
And I love the fact that Andre pointed this out, is the fact that you have this timeline split into two, and you have the Doctor Strange that decides to simply move on. And the Doctor Strange is just simply cannot do it. Mm-hmm. And it shows that obviously in life, us human beings, we all lose people and we have losses. We suffer from time to time.
Yes.
And we always have a choice. Yep. Do you move on from that? Or do you let it consume you to the point where it becomes your own destruction?
Yes.
And I love that it addressed that, because that's kind of a darker element. That's a darker element that maybe some people will never really experience to a big extent, but it's a difficult choice.
Well, yeah. I like how, you know, she's, you know, essentially split him. And so there's two timelines, but you think about it, this all happened after the multiverse had been unleashed. So it essentially, she probably already knew that it happened. So she's like, okay, well, I'm going to do this in order to save, you know, attempt to save this universe. Instead, the universe collapsed on itself.
But he's still
there.
Because she also appears to the good Strange as like a time echo of some sort, you know, where she kind of projects herself from the past and is like, hey, your timeline's split in two, and it's because you did this, but it wasn't really you. It was you, and it's like that's where things kind of I'm just like,
well,
huh. But she does mention that she pulls from the dark dimension to do that. I'm like, all right, there's your write-in for that. But even still, I'm just like, I want to see how that visually works.
Well, and the other thing too that I thought about with this movie was that, you know, we know that with DC that they're going to be doing the whole Flash, and you know, the idea that, you know, the villain of the Flash might be another version of the Flash of Barry Allen. And so now you see this kind of story take place in What If. It makes you wonder if there's something similar that's going to happen. What's up, Jesse? Something similar is going to happen in the Flash storyline, where, you know, you're going to have another version of himself trying to stop himself and fighting. You know, he's basically going to be fighting himself. But I mean, obviously, circumstances would be a little bit different, but still, as Anthony says, trash point trash movie. Point there movie. You go.
Trash point movie.
Is it in this they finally confirmed that the way the whole multiverse is made up of universes, and in each individual universe, there are multiple timelines, if not managed and made by one, he who remains. Yeah.
So, yeah. It, it slowly is unraveling the mystery of the multiverse, what it means, how it works with the MCU. And I love that because the multiverse is something that you have to, especially the general audience, you have to address it gradually. Like you introduce it, you kind of let them know what it is. We help them to better understand it as it goes along, right?
What up, Ryan?
Whereas if you're simply, what's up, man? Whereas if you're simply Warner Brothers, you're simply going to be like, oh, this one movie explains everything, which is going to be The Flash.
I mean, it's well, if you're Warner Brothers, you're like, okay, here comes DC fandom. We got to make sure we say multiverse at least 7,500 times. Okay, let's go. And they just kept saying, multiverse. And then, but that's all they've done. They haven't done anything. They haven't done anything to establish their universe whatsoever. The movies they have put out are essentially standalones that haven't accomplished anything. They haven't built anything. While you look over the MCU, they're like, oh, well, guess what? We're going in a new direction. It's going to be multiverse. And guess what? Now they've laid out the groundwork, and they're continuing to lay out the groundwork for what their universe, what their universe is going to be, while DC is still sitting on their ass trying to figure out what to do next. And now, obviously, they might have a plan. Well, they say they have a plan. What's up? And, you know, we're going to get to see that as it plays out. But so far, they haven't done anything to really kind of bring that together or even say what they're going to do. Like, okay, this is what's going to happen. You know, anything. There's no plan that's been presented yet.
They don't even have a plug.
Yeah, no. Yeah.
All they have is a P.
Let's be really clear here. I think we're all originally, when it comes to like this content, not just, I'm talking about before the movies and shit, like comic books, like we're probably mostly DC fans. I know that I am. I've said before, the only Marvel that I read when I was a kid was Spider-Man and X-Men. So like DC was what I read. I'll be clear and say that something like the multiverse was something that DC brought up in the comics, in their lore, and they fucking thrived at that shit. Like that's a popular thing when it comes to DC fans, as far as the comics are concerned. So I'll be clear. Marvel is clapping DC's cheeks right now with the multiverse shit. Straight destroying them because you know, people at the top don't know what the fuck they're doing. So now we're look, this is not just because I'm a DC fan, I don't like Marvel shit. We're obviously talking about a show that's absolute fucking fire.
Yeah.
Based on Marvel characters. And you know what I mean? So like, but let's be like, that's a thing that like I've thought about it a few times over the past couple of months. Like DC was known for the multiverse. Now Marvel's going to come in and they're going to do it better than them because they can't get their heads out of their asses enough to like actually do it on a level that like that the fans know what the fans want. They're not going to give it to them because they're mad at somebody. So
well, it's like you said, Anthony, for a long time, because of the DC comics, when you thought of the term multiverse and you heard that term, you instantly thought DC comics or The Flash. Mm-hmm. That's the thing you thought of. Either that, or if you're more of a Marvel fan, the Spider-Verse, right?
Yes.
One of those two things. But you're absolutely right. In fact, I said this. I said this as the multiverse thing for DC was established and that Loki was show was going to be happening. I knew right then that Marvel was going to win the multiverse game because A, they're going to get to it first. B, they have ground they can build it on, a solid foundation, because we all know that when you try to build something on a foundation made of sand or something unstable, it doesn't work. It doesn't stand, and that's what DC is trying to do. Whereas Marvel, they have a very solid, concrete, leveled out foundation ready to go with characters that have been established, some that have already been established, had their arcs and died. You've already had this universe built to hold a multiverse now. And DC is trying to do the same thing at the same time when they don't have that same foundation. And it's not going to bode well for them. Like, regardless of if the movie The Flash is going to end up quality or not, I mean, Andy Muschietti is a good director, so credit where credit is due. But regardless of what he does with that movie, the multiverse will not feel earned in the DCEU. It will not, no matter what they do, no matter what. And again, that's no slight to Andy Muschietti. It's just how it is. It wasn't built up. The structure's not there. And so no matter what, after The Flash movie, the Marvel's going to still be winning the multiverse game. And they will win it for the foreseeable future.
Yeah. I mean, just, 35 minutes of this. Fire. You know what I mean? And they can't, they just. So, and that's just what I was just trying to say. Basically, what you like pretty much summed up, Dawson, is just like, like that's what I grew up reading, and that's what that's one of the things that made me a fan of DC Comics was the Infinite Earths, the those types of stories.
Yeah.
And now they let another thing come in, and they're gonna do it better. They're gonna do it better.
They're killing it. And that's why I was saying, you know, on Monday I was like, you know, should DC, you know, invest in something, a series or whatnot called DC Elseworlds, where you just basically have individual storylines from different. Different comics played out, you know, even in animation, you know, and they've done that a lot already, but they haven't like established it as like, hey, this is an Elseworlds series or something that kind of different, that kind of reinforces the idea that yes, this is a multiverse, and we've had this for, we also have the same thing.
It's like again, Anthony said it best when you grow up reading DC Comics, multiverse is a prevalent thing. Now, when you go about 10 years into the future, you know, kids and younger people who are reading comics or watching comic movies, when they think multiverse, they'll think Marvel first instead.
Yes.
And that is a huge L on the heads of Warner Brothers executives, how you take one thing that DC is well known for, besides, of course, Superman and Batman, and totally just let another comic company and studio take that title away from you.
Yes.
Because of incompetence.
I would definitely agree, because, I mean, growing up, when anyone said multiverse, I would think, oh, it's DC. DC does that. DC has the multiverse.
Yeah.
And now, you know, Marvel has firmly established their own multiverse. Not to say there doesn't exist to begin with, but I'm saying that they have firmly established it within, you know, their fan base. And it's like you said, you know, as kids growing up, they're going to be like, oh, multiverse. Yeah, it's Marvel does that. Because they, and it's not a knock against them whatsoever, if anything.
At all.
It's a credit to them, exactly, because they have their shit together and they're doing a great job. And like I said, you know, Ryan Rivera was saying how he hasn't seen it yet. It's definitely watched What If. This episode is off the hook. I was like, dude, this is the best What If episode I've so far.
That's my favorite one. It is pretty good. Absolutely. You know, House Epic. Yeah, that shit was fire, dude.
Epic.
It's really tough because, like, WB has shot themselves in the foot every single time when it comes to trying.
They've shot each individual toe.
Right, yeah. Right. You know, like, pow, pow, pow. Like, oh god! It just sucks that like nubs? they decided to just kind of go in a more cash grabby kind of direction after seeing the Avengers, and in wake of that, you have Zack Snyder, a filmmaker who just wants to make great DC movies, great movies about DC characters, like other directors before him, like Christopher Nolan.
Without any influence from that.
Right. Yeah. And it's like, you know, Marvel was still doing their thing. And it's like, you know, you have both of these, you know, two different kind of factions kind of representing one another, and they're like doing different things. But because there were so many people who were just like, well, this one thing isn't like the other thing, and I think that's nonsense, so I'm going to sit here and do whatever it takes to make sure that this thing is like the other thing. It's just like, well, that's not fair to the people who like the other thing because of the other. It's just,
yeah,
it's really tough. And to Dawson's point, it really is kind of unfortunate that the entire multiverse, at least as far as films are concerned, because, you know, there are a lot of DC fans who would consider that the multiverse started on Crisis on Infinite Earths and whatever with, you know, the two Flashes meeting. That's perfectly viable and understandable. But just as far as like establishing a multiverse on film, I've always thought that that was the best way for WB as a director driven studio to operate no matter what. But at the same time, to everyone else's point, it's like, why can't you not also do a very consistent streamlined storyline that is dedicated to a very set version of these characters? But you also are WB, you have DC IP, like you have multiverse in your Elseworlds titles, like utilize that. But exactly. Again, you know, when it comes to like contractual rights and things like that, characters like Batman and Superman, they go back pretty far. So they're a little bit more murkier. But I would imagine that anything outside of that after that, it's a little more open game because you see almost no interference when it comes to putting certain characters on TV or in a movie. It's very interesting. But when it comes to Batman and Superman, it's always something different.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, we've seen that with every single iteration of Batman so far. Like, there's always been something different brought to the table. Even when you had Michael Keaton in his two movies, it was a slightly different thing in both those movies with the same actor. And then you have Val Kilmer, then you have George Clooney, then you have Christian Bale, then Ben Affleck, now Robert Pattinson. There's a new thing brought to the table every single time. And again, like you said, it does make it a little murky. It makes it to where it makes it a little complicated to figure out, okay, which fans of a version of Batman do you want to please? But at the same time, it's like, I feel like a lot of the stress about that isn't necessary because a lot of that has to do with fans. I think fans, a lot of fans, not all of them, but a lot of fans have caused an issue as far as creating content about these characters. Because a lot of them have a very set idea in their mind as to what a character should be, even though, and I swear, I hate arguing with people about this because it's so nonsensical to me. Even though there are like hundreds of different versions of all these characters in comics that you can pull from. So it's like, okay, are you a fan of the character in general? Or are you only a fan of a specific version? Because if you're only a fan of a specific version, you're shortchanging other people who are fans of other versions by saying it should only be the way that you see it. When again, comics have gone on for closing in on about 100 years now. Closing in on that. And these characters have been around for almost as long. And so if you're going to shortchange these people with these different, the specific version you want, that's just not fair. So people just got to be a little more open-minded. I think a lot of it has to do with fans. You got to be willing to accept differences in types of characters that you see on screen. And it also takes a lot of pressure off of studios in a sense. I don't know if any of that made sense.
Yeah. But. Oh, no, it did. Yeah. So, yeah, they're they're yes, they're destroying my favorite comic book company with their
I mean, so let's say when the Flash comes out, they fully establish that, you know, they fully establish the multiverse within DC, right?
Well, under 2 hours.
Under 2 hours on like a cinematic scale, but let's say, you know, that's what they accomplish, which would be a good thing. Then you can literally have, you know, if you establish, you know, the Elseworlds type, you know, that theme, you can literally have miniseries and movies that are labeled, you know, DC Elseworlds. And you can, like Ryan was saying earlier, Ryan Rivera, that, you know, you can have a Superman Red Sun miniseries. It doesn't have to be Cavill. It could be another actor. You know what I mean? So you can do different things with the characters based on these comic book runs that have come out. And so it allows you to enrich your universe. And I think that'd be really cool.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. Absolutely agree.
Couldn't agree more.
We're all in agreement. He's like, oh, I'm the host. Shit.
I mean, it just kind of sucks that there really isn't like a hard direction that they have for any set, you know, amount of characters. It really is just kind of stick it at a wall, see if it happens. If it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. Anything further than that, and it's just because
the thing is, like, if you're gonna branch out, like again, the multiverse is often been compared to branches on the tree, right? Sure.
Yeah.
You have to have a trunk. You have to have a solid trunk for it to branch out from. That's where it has to originate from. You can't just simply have it's it like roots, be branched
roots,
out of nowhere.
Roots of hair or roots of a tree.
Oh, I thought you meant like roots. Yeah, the show. I was like, really? It's like roots?
No, I'm talking about. Anyway, my point stands.
Anthony knows what I'm talking about.
He's a big fan of roots.
What?
Way to ruin a perfectly good analogy. Anyhow,
okay.
So the accountant too.
Yes,
so the accountant too. Yeah. Well, I mean, have you guys talked about DC fandom?
I don't want to talk about it.
Well, I mean, there are a few things I am excited for, like the Batman. I want to see that.
Yes. Yeah. Black Adam.
So let's ask them. What are you guys excited for when it comes to DC fandom? Because I'm just, you know.
Yeah. I'll start with Phil.
Let's see. The Batman first and foremost.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because Batman. Then after that directly is Black Adam. I feel like that's going to be the next like biggest corner of the universe that gets carved out. So I'm looking forward to that. And then after that is probably Aquaman Lost Kingdom, because I'm a pretty big fan of the first film. And then that's about it. Sure. Fear of the Gods. I've got interest in
Super Pets.
Fear of the Gods should be at least slightly intriguing.
I'm hoping to see some like comic panels. I'm hoping to see something for Young Justice, if I'm being totally honest, because I'm curious to see what they do with season four.
Are they going to, I didn't know if they were going to do that, because I thought like season three was such a dud. As far as
Wiseman said that, I never like 19 episodes are in the cat or in the can. So they're definitely doing a season four.
Like in the trash or
in the can. Oh no.
Get this thing out of here.
Like, you guys like the Spectacular Spider-Man? You guys ever watch that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Same guy.
Interesting. I didn't realize that.
Andre's like, everything burns.
Everything burns.
Everything burns.
Trying to find a graphic that has all the different panels.
Gotham Knights, definitely.
I'm looking forward to that. I just don't like the glowy weapons. But other than that, you know, I think it'll be fun. It's you can play with like your, I guess, a team.
Yep.
Four people.
That's one of the things.
That'd be cool.
Yeah, that'll be fun. I mean, I think we talked about it. It was on one of your stream, I think, Ryan. We were talking about.
I think so. Because I mean, I like it. I guess I'm spoiled from like Arkham, you know, the Arkham series.
Sure.
Yeah. And playing Robin, Nightwing, whatever, you know, getting the unlock characters, Batgirl. I think I'm just a little bit, you know, maybe spoiled because those are pretty fun.
Spoiled. Little brat.
I'm curious to see like what other villains pop up outside of the Court of Owls because they already showed Mr. Freeze. But
well,
like,
they're bringing in Black Mask, but then they're gonna blow him up mid game.
Blow his head off.
Blows head off.
I don't think the Joker's gonna show up.
He's gonna come in. Hello there.
I actually hope the Joker doesn't show up because
I'm kind of hoping that.
But then again, this is a whole different series, though. This is not even related to Arkham,
which is so weird because this looks like it takes place almost directly after Arkham Knight.
And Batman's not even in it, right? Isn't it just everybody else? Or is Batman in it?
The theory is that Bruce Wayne will be a Court of Owls you have to fight at the end of the game.
Okay. But still, I mean, you could totally tie this into the end of Arkham Knight, you know?
Is it the same studio that's making this one?
It's WB Montreal, and they did Arkham Origins.
Okay. But and do they have the rights to make it tied in? Maybe that's the reason.
They've said that it's not, but the thing is, like, every character that they've pulled from has literally been in Arkham. They're Arkham franchise. Like, they have the main characters are Dick Grayson, Jason Todd, Tim Drake, and Barbara Gordon.
Yeah.
So... Well, I guess the big difference is Barbara's walking in and Arkham, she's in a wheelchair. So I guess there's that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does she have one leg or two?
Two. In Titans, she only has the one leg. She hops.
I can't just the legs.
She has the hop.
We probably have not all seen the
hot legs
Titans, but we'll talk about that tomorrow night.
He wants to save for his show.
Anthony, I know you've seen it. Have Ryan Dawson, Andre, have you guys seen Titans yet?
Andre, hey,
I haven't seen all of it yet. My whole life,
I haven't yet.
Okay,
but so
I don't care about being spoiled.
It just came out today. I'm not
Titans. No, I haven't seen Titans yet.
If you had a warning.
real quick, last week's episode of Four Nerds, there were some giveaways for some codes for Snake Eyes. If you were not able to win one of those codes, we'd just like to let you know that it is available to purchase on digital copy.
Get early access to Snake Eyes G.I. Joe Origins on digital today. In this action-packed adventure the critics are calling the best G.I. Joe movie yet, the iconic hero Snake Eyes rises to become the ultimate warrior in the battle against Cobra. Buy Snake Eyes G.I. Joe Origins on digital today and get all new special features, including a bonus short film, deleted scenes, and much more, available at participating retailers. Rated PG-13 from Paramount Pictures.
If you weren't able to win one of the digital download codes to watch the movie with the code, it is available for Paramount Pictures to purchase.
And yo, we're gonna have more giveaways right here on this channel.
Yes.
In fact, I'm gonna do one right now. This mug. No, I'm just kidding. we will have more giveaways on the channel. Unfortunately, this episode we do not, but in the future we're gonna have a lot more. So stay tuned for that.
Indeed. Indeed.
Yes.
Indeed.
You afraid of those bat wheels?
Yeah, I do.
Bat wheels.
I do.
Bat wheels.
I'm down.
Andre. Yes.
Andre.
Hey, Andre.
I thought nicotine, and then I said,
it's been my whole life.
I'm sorry.
Mispronounce it. No, I don't care. you know, one thing I did want to bring up, though, is that on Titans, Red Hood,
Kid Hood. It's Kid Hood.
Yeah, it's Kid Hood. He's too much of a kid. But then again, he was Robin, so I guess. He's a little annoying.
What's up, Joey?
Sorry, I'm sad. He mentioned Titans.
The Red Hood mask. I don't really like it.
I think the eyes are too big.
I don't like how it protrudes out. He looks like kind of apish. He's like.
Well, I mean, there's some cosplay Red Hood helmets or masks or whatever out there that look freaking dope. I think they did a better job than the show. Here, let me see if I can find one, because I saw one that was just amazing.
It seemed like
I don't have a problem.
What's his name? Bloodsport's mask.
Bloodsport
was phenomenal. I was like, that's a badass mask. But then you go to Red Hood, and I understand it's very simplistic in its nature. But still, I don't know. I mean, it works, I guess. But the actor, he shows his face way too much.
The actor.
It's one of those cases again where it's like, how do we get him out of the mask? So let's get him out of the mask as much as we can and keep him in the mask when he doesn't need to talk or do any dialogue. And that's what I don't like about masks is that they're always trying to get them out of the mask. Like look at Captain America. I mean, they were trying to get him out of that mask every minute they could. Whenever they find a reason to take the mask off, take it off. You know,
it's the same thing with what's his face, Will Smith. You know, they're like, we've got this fire character, and he wears a helmet like 90% of the time. Oh, we got Will Smith coming in. Okay, so like 5% of the time.
Yeah, he'll have it on a couple.
Give him a monocle.
Yeah, a monocle.
If he comes back, if Will Smith comes back, the next time they see him in a Suicide Squad movie, he gets like a CGI metal mask. That way, they don't have to like worry about like having him.
It'll be like Star Wars. Iron Man. Nanotech. Mm-hmm. He'll go like this and go.
Bloodsport.
He was like,
right. Yeah. There's another good example.
Go, nanotech. I was like, okay. This is kind of weird.
That's what I would love to see.
With Bloodsport, in the comics, we know that he's able to teleport weapons from wherever he wants. But at the same time, like in the movie, they don't establish any of that. So all of a sudden, it's like you have a transforming gun in his hand and rock music playing. You're supposed to care. It's just like, hold on. How is he doing this? Like,
just go with it.
I guess. I do like the fact
I like that he could take off pieces of himself and make guns. Yes. That was cool. I was like, oh, that's pretty cool.
Yes, but I think they could make it more practical to where, like, the parts are more bulky, so he looks a little bit more intimidating. The armor also works to where it, like, makes sense. He builds the gun right there. I think it just would have worked better in that way, personally.
Sure. Yeah, I never did like the square.
Slap it on the gun. Don't worry about it. We're going to make it look really cool in post. Okay, you got it.
All right, Anthony, I sent you an image, fire image that a fan did, and I think it's better than what they did in the show.
That
looks way better.
I like that.
You know why it's better? It's because there's a little bit of black around the eyes. The eyes in the show are just all white, and I think that kind of kills it.
But I like this though. It has a weathered look to
it. It's weathered. Yeah, I mean that's what it sells it that he's. He's done something in this, and he's, you know, this is a real guy, and you know, he's not just clean, you know.
That's the thing. It's too clean.
Yeah.
Well, he did just start.
A good example of taking technology and making it more realistic in the sense that, like, you know, the technology that we see in special effects, it's too clean. When you look at, like, the work of, like, Neil Blomkamp, of his technology, you know, all his scenes, like everything's dirty, they're dusty, there's trash. But I like that though; it's more realistic. Exactly. You know what I mean?
It's the same with like Star Wars. You know, I mean, that was a dirty universe, and then that was one of the issues that that people had with the prequels was that everything was just so clean, right? Mm-hmm. And it was like
as a whistle.
It was all clean. It was pristine. Even though it was a lived-in universe still. And you did see, like, you know, I mean, I've seen a lot of stuff, you know, up close, but I mean, there was grime, but it just wasn't, it just didn't have that same feeling. Well, it didn't carry over.
With Star Wars, I will say that the prequel trilogy had an established overall galactic republic, whereas the original trilogy had an empire and it was all like scattered and very disorganized and just simply being ruled by an evil overlord. So there's a little bit of a difference in context as like
it being clean and dirty. Well, hold on a minute now. Now, I mean, like in the prequels, it was a lot cleaner because it was an established government and they made sense.
What I just said.
Exactly. In the original, he's talking about the sequel trilogy. You're talking about the prequels. In the sequel trilogy,
I misheard that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, screwed that one up. But so in the sequel trilogy, it should have been more grimy. And what's funny is that when they were looking for a director for these projects, I know that originally they actually did contact or they approached Neil Blomkamp to see if he'd be interested in one of these projects because they loved what he did with that you know making the looks that he gave in his movies, but it never really worked out. But that was the one thing I thought would have been really cool is if you would have had that type of look to Star Wars, you know. And you kind of saw it with the X-Wings. They look kind of weathered and old. But
mm-hmm. And the same.
Exactly. And I was say, as Ryan's about before, there was no evolution in their technology. Like, oh, so you're using the planes you used 30 years ago. Okay.
All right, cue up the silhouettes.
Yeah. But yeah, no, I mean, there were differences. Like there's the size of the fuselage is different, you know, or the shape and all that. They made subtle changes, but it was just like
squeakles.
The squeakles, the squeaky clean, yeah.
Ray!
Ray! Is that all you do is yell?
Nah, if they did reach out to Neil Blomkamp for real, they're probably just like, yo, and he's just like, I want Chateau Copley to play a Skywalker. And they were like, okay.
Yeah,
he can't be in all your fucking movies. So get the fuck out.
They were like, relax. We got a lady that's not a Skywalker that's gonna say she's a Skywalker. We got it.
Yeah. I feel so bad. Like JJ had to come back and do that last movie, and it like everything stacked against him too. And
no, I've said that shit a million times. He was in a no-win situation no matter what he did with that movie, lose. L's. Yep. That's all he was catching. Because I'll say it again, and I don't think I've said it on the stream in 6 months. Don't make a trilogy with three different directors. Get the fuck out of here with that shit. That's a no-no, dude.
Without setting up an established through-line story first, you know?
Yeah. Especially those directors who have like, egos like that. Or not Matt, I was about to say Matt Reeves, but fucking... what's his name?
But no, yeah. I mean...
Ryan Johnson.
Johnson. No, but like, you can do that with three different directors, but you have to have someone on top.
You have to have like a narrative, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You have to have a plan, as J.J. Abrams learned.
Because now, granted, the OG trilogy...
didn't have one. It wasn't like...
He was like, guys,
I'm not gonna do that. We're doing this, and remember? Lost. It was like, I leave it up to the directors. Thank you. You're like, was Palpatine really? Always in the works?
Yes.
Yeah, he's a Titan's garbage.
And the big difference, that's a lie.
And I've been thinking about this. The big difference between like, you know, the OG trilogy and the sequel trilogy is that, you know, yes, the OG trilogy. Hold on. The OG trilogy mm-hmm. had one through line. That through line was George Lucas. Now, did he make the story up on the fly? 100%. He absolutely did. But this is before Star Wars what it is now.
Yeah.
So you fast forward, you know, 30 something years, and you got someone like Bob Iger, like, hey, let me help you make a movie. And then it turns into, hey, let me take your company. And then it turns into, hey, let's make Star Wars movies the same way, but without the one same component.
What is it?
Or at least one something similar.
He's like, you know what? I'm out.
This is all about the word Ray. No.
I actually like this fight.
Me too.
Yeah, I love that bit.
Yeah. They were like, hey, we need to find something. Cool. Go to episode 3. We'll make another fight, but just this time it's in water.
Watch.
Yes.
Dude, oh, yes. Man.
Oh, my God. Yes.
Oh man, that's my favorite one of the sequel trilogy.
Now,
damn, that's
now
good.
I like the sequel trilogy.
That was funny.
I will say The Last Jedi is probably like my least favorite of the sequel trilogy.
Yes,
I still think the best thing about it is Luke Skywalker. Funny enough,
I don't like the movie at all. But I mean, that's fair. Yeah. That's fine.
I think It's always that weird argument that like
you will lose.
People, be careful with your ass. Like,
you will lose.
The Force Awakens came out, and there were so many people like they retreaded this. So then Rian Johnson came in and turned that shit all upside down on its head. And then now that's too different, though. Wait a minute, we said different, but not that fucking.
Hey, I don't know. Hey, calm down with this.
I'm sorry.
Ryan kind of gave you the same. It was still the same, but different. It was twisted here and there. Like he had his own Lando. He had his own. I was just gonna say,
like of seven, at least with going into seven, JJ was like, "Look, I don't want to do exactly what George did with the prequel trilogy and make it all entirely CGI. I like that he did a blend of it."
Oh yeah. Well, that was the biggest complaint that everyone had, and that's why they made it such a point. We're like, "Yo, we're doing practical," and that was one of the good calls that he made was going practical instead of like that was one thing I didn't like about George's approach was that. Even though yes, the technology was there. Yes, it was kind of like Matrix, you know.
Yeah,
it was up and coming, and it was just like you know, what all can we do? Let's push the envelope for you know creativity. Well, that's great, but you're letting the story and everything else suffer because of you want to press or push forward technology.
Right.
And that's and again, same thing. The problem with the prequels, and I've always said this, is George Lucas doesn't know how to direct people's interactions. Like he's very stable himself. He's a good. He's a good story. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Faster and more intense. He's a great director. He's a great technical director. He's not good with like, and that's why Irvin Kershner, his mentor, came in and like really fleshed out those characters. Yeah. And then you know the characters already and the actors already kind of knew what they were doing, and that's what George really kind of leaned on was like, I want professionals. So that he doesn't have to really, you know, tell them how to engage or interact. And that's why a lot of the dialogue between the characters in the prequels is very stale and not, you know, very, what do I want to say? It just emotional, right? You lose the emotionality. And
well,
so
the lighting too, everything was like super bright and it was just kind of like, this looks fake.
I will still always say, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, that, harking back to The Last Jedi, and I've said this before, and I'll say it again. It was one of my favorite theater experiences in the sense that I went in there with all these different theories going around on YouTube of who Snoke was, and they freaking killed him, and then, like, literally just flipped everything on its head. I sat there like, ha! Suck it, theorists.
Well, the only issue I had with that, which would have been cool, but it was like, well, now what? Now it's kind of like, okay, that didn't accomplish anything positive for the story because it was like you took away this big bad, right?
You took a piece off the board, but without any real good reason why.
Right. There you go.
Yeah, and because Kylo Ren, I felt that Kylo Ren was not developed enough to where I was like, oh yeah, he can run the First Order now, and he could like he's a bad guy. Got it.
Yeah, like if you had really if Kylo Ren was more yet. Like Darth Vader. You know, we're like in the first feat, you know, in the first feature, you're like, okay, I've got it. I understand.
Yeah, like this guy and he is a can, badass.
He can handle shit, right? But with Kylo, you know, and the whole, you know, having a tantrum and all this other stuff or whatever, and the hissy fit with what's his face? The guy from the Harry Potter Hux, right.
He came in, I'm talking about the hissy fit when he's like they left, and he just starts beating up the machine. With
that right? No, see, no, no.
I like
you're
that.
Right.
I like you're that right. Part and of it because it's
funny.
Kind of, you know.
But then I also like when they were talking to Snoke, and then you know they were kind of like kind of trying to one up each other in front of Snoke.
I was like, nah.
You know, at the end of Last Jedi when they did that, I was like, yeah, he's not a developed enough character to sort of be the big bad of the universe. And of course, you know, lo and behold, you know, Emperor all along, but that was never, you know, that was never the thing. But it was just like, dude, there's no other big bad out there. And they teased something else. They teased like this big alien creature that was supposed to be off somewhere else or whatever. Oh, no. And Kylo's supposed to go visit him or some shit.
In Trevorrow's script, he brought in some other wholly entirely new Sith Lord that was apparently Palpatine's long lost instructor. I personally thought it was kind of ridiculous, all things considered. Mm-hmm. And there, as far as Kylo Ren's concerned, I honestly think he's stronger than Darth Vader.
Emotionally, I think he's stronger.
I think if purely emotionally, but also in terms of like force and saber scale, but that also could be included the fact that Vader was missing all of his limbs.
If Kylo was at the peak of his physicality and force versus Anakin Skywalker at the top of his with all of his limbs, physicality and force, Anakin would beat him every time, in my opinion.
The thing that really bothers me.
I'd love to see that fight. Like an Elseworlds?
Yes.
I don't understand why they made it to where, both Rey and Finn were able to pick up a lightsaber and fight with Kylo Ren. I mean, like Finn, I understand he's a stormtrooper, but I've seen a lot of them just get annihilated. So what makes him better than the rest?
He took his helmet off.
He's literally having a lightsaber battle with Kylo Ren. Who's being trained as a Jedi? I mean, now as a Sith Lord,
a Sith Lord,
a Fifth. He's a Fifth.
I feel like
Revenge of the Fifth.
I plead the Fifth.
When Finn had the lightsaber and he was like, "You want it? Come and get it." He should have just took him down immediately. Like
see, that's the thing though. Like,
you're like, shit, he's a badass. Okay,
his overconfidence was his weakness.
And then he was also hit. He was also hit with Chewie's bowcaster, which typically takes motherfuckers out.
I know that, but still, that's one of those things where it's like, oh, well, he got hit by the bowcaster. That's why he's. But to me, if you're trying to establish a character, you're trying to establish a narrative, you're trying to build this character up. That would have been a good scene for me. Is if here comes Finn trying to fight him, then you realize, oh yeah, he doesn't stand a chance because this guy's way more trained than he is with a lightsaber. And then you got Rey who picks it up. And obviously at this point, Kylo's already jacked up. But
she knows how to fight because she's a Palpatine.
Yeah.
While a lot of people like to say that they never explained that, they tried to, but all of the Jedi are in you at the end of the trip. That's how they tried to explain how fire she was so fast in the
well first I will argue
I mean
with
she
that,
was giving like, fire over Han Solo with the Falcon, right?
Because like
she knew about the Falcon better than he did.
I get the whole like piloting thing. Yeah, her being able to pilot thing better than anyone else has just made no sense. But the lightsaber thing, like, I will argue that I feel like most people, I mean, obviously most people won't have like the forms and stuff of fighting, right? Most people, if you give them a weapon like that, they can at least be somewhat of a threat.
She did.
The only thing she has in her favor is when she was on that.
And again, he's also
in planet, and she had her staff, and she was like, so she knows how to defend herself. You know, she's had to sort of, I get that. But as far as like, she should have been as good a lightsaber combatant as Finn, because Finn is also trained in, hand-to-hand combat and things like that. So I can understand how he was able to do whatever he did. He lost because, at that time, he didn't have the force, but apparently he will when he gets his own, series. But he's like, and everybody don't forget, his motherfucker said, "You'll never Disney Plus me." So they're going to Disney Plus his ass. So,
can you really blame him?
He wants the money.
I really didn't like that in The Force Awakens where he's like, "I'm force sensitive." I was like, oh, come on. Like,
Rise of Skywalker, not Force Awakens.
Yeah,
so, whatever. Yeah, the Rise of Skywalker. I was just like, oh my God. Like, get at it.
Well, now, what a hater. You don't even know what movie you're talking about.
I know.
Remember that movie? Yeah, it sucked.
Well, I think that's had the right trilogy
about
at
Star
least.
Wars. Is like, Star Wars is just such a personal thing to so many different people because it's encapsulated so many different generations. And then you also take into account like the expanded universe that came before the sequel trilogy. So, like, all of that, you've got a lot of fans who are probably pretty PO'd about certain things not being present. Sure. Yeah, 100%. I can definitely understand that.
Do you guys think that in the sequel trilogy that the main bad guy, instead of being Palpatine, which is, to me, that's an easy callback. Should it have been someone like Plagueis?
Well, yeah, I mean, I feel
Plagueis
like
that would have been
dope from an because that would have tied into the prequels.
Right, that too.
Yeah,
Plagueis was definitely
because when Palpatine alluded to him when they were at the whatever that was,
the opera with the water.
Yeah, with the water. Yeah. The WAPRA.
But yeah, it would have tied that in. Like, did you ever tell me about the blah blah blah? And it was like, wow, you know, you could really, you know, expound on that and make it all tie in together. Like, wow, that's you know, that's so wow. It's it widens the story, it widens the narrative versus
it's shitty because
like closing what it you're up doing and saying, is you're this tying, is your universe that's
you're tying
really
the sequel
small.
Trilogy into the prequel trilogy. You're making a connection. You're jumping over trilogies.
It's kind of like what Warner Brothers Skywalker is trying to do
within the
like,
first 5 minutes of the movie. By doing clones, so.
But the thing is like with Warner Brothers trying to dismiss Justice League, Disney was trying to dismiss connection to the prequels. Like they're like, okay, yeah, people like the Clone Wars, we'll continue with that. But they're not really doing anything with the prequel trilogy as far as like going back
very
and
vague, especially with the last two movies.
Yeah,
there was very, very
not,
vague connections.
No references, no talk about midichlorians. Not that I wanted it, but I'm saying there wasn't much connection to the prequel
trilogy. Their theory was the same as Warner Brothers, like, okay, they want light and fluffy. The thing with Disney was like, okay, you know, they
like
don't
the eggs
from 1977.
Just like their eggs,
scrambled,
yes.
Light and fluffy, right?
Light and fluffy.
Gross.
Yo, was that egg from 1977? It better be.
And they even had the opportunity to bring back Hayden Christensen,
Anthony, what are you
which
doing?
Would have been freaking dope to have him physically there on camera. I don't know if he came in and did ADR work or if he actually came in and they shot him and all they did was just use his voice. But if he was actually in the shot on the screen, like so many people out there on YouTube have put, I was like, dude, he's at that age. You put a fucking wig on him and make him, you know, transparent or translucent or whatever, and he's fine. He's a ghost. We know he's a little bit older in age or whatever, but we're willing to dismiss that and say, hey, you know what? You included him, one of the most powerful and popular characters in the whole damn franchise.
Yeah,
but they didn't do that. They used his voice, and I thought that was so weak.
Mm, I agree with that.
It was super weak. He should have been in the sequel trilogy somehow, some way. You should have had at least Anakin Skywalker something.
Anakin trying to fucking contact somebody or some shit. The last time you see Anakin is in episode 6.
You know what would have worked for me is if Hayden Christensen would have came and talked to Ben Solo. That would have made a whole
I'm so sorry. They should not have brought back Harrison to do that shot. They should have had Anakin.
I can agree with that.
Because he cares about Anakin. He doesn't give a shit about his dad. The only reason why I think they did that was because Carrie died. And they were we need another. Like,
I can see that. Yeah,
we need to bring him back.
I will say, when Kylo finally called him dad, that got me. I was like, oh, he shows he's still bent on inside.
Well, and I know that they wanted to bring the character full circle. Like, look, now you know he's making the turn. You know, but I do believe that if it was Hayden Christensen, then
a whole big deal of difference.
Here is that idol that he's been trying to
that would
live
have been
up to,
like nostalgia. Would have
realized like, oh my god, like. Now he like this is the guy that I've been trying to emulate. And literally, he's telling me, you know,
he had his burnt helmet. I mean, he had other relics, you know.
That,
and he,
but
he,
see, that's
he
what I'm saying.
He tried to commune with him. Right. He's like, you know, tell me again, you know, of the you know, blah blah blah. He's talking to the helmet or whatever. But I mean, again, you know, they had this really interesting concept, which was like there's a balance with the spirits as well. Like they have a light side and a dark side.
Right.
And even though he's passed, you know, through the force, he still kind of, he can shift between because he's the chosen one. And so, you know, it could be that, you know, he knew how to balance the force, and how you balance the force is you have, you know, which is what Palpatine was trying to do, is destroy all the Jedi to where there's only two or one Sith or two Sith and two Jedi, so that you have balance.
One Sith, two Sith, three Sith, four Sith.
Red Sith, blue Sith.
Yep.
Well,
and it's just, there were those little elements that they put into The Force Awakens that I thought was that were good, that I was intrigued by, especially like having the helmet, you know, of Darth Vader that he would talk to.
And now like, that makes zero fucking sense.
Now it was a waste. And you had that there, and it was so polarizing. You're like, wow, look at it. He's literally talking to the head of Darth Vader to try and, like, you know, bring this essence out of himself. It was awesome. I was like, wow, this is really, really cool stuff. And, I mean, yeah, Rey was able to read his mind, which I was like,
Oh, come on. You got
to
share this.
Oh, because he was talking to his head?
Something about his head. Yeah, it is. It's the head comment.
And then he's trying to draw his essence from
him. He's trying to draw his essence from his head.
Well, that's what he was doing, though. And so, but like they had aspects that were really,
like,
really
use
cool.
the force.
Or like, especially when they introduced Luke's lightsaber. Like, how the fuck did it get there? And, like, where did it come from?
The force. They have this whole stupid thing where his hand was supposed to be floating.
No, that would have been stupid.
Andre, just stop talking. Just stop talking.
You're the only one laughing at this joke, by the way. That would have been really dumb to have the hand like floating in space with a lightsaber in it. I'll agree.
Like that the level of what with the whole force like exchange of the light. I was just like, that's a little much.
The story for another time should have been something where it would have traveled to, you know, the Lando Calrissian, you know, meeting, because it came from Bespin. So he could have got it from like an Ugnaught that found some, you know, found it. And right. He was like, yo, that's, I know who Saber
is. They should have had Floyd Christmas from Dumb and Dumber come in and say, I'm talking about a little place called Bespin. Lloyd Christmas. I don't know why I said, yeah, Lloyd Christmas.
You said,
yeah.
You said Floyd Christmas.
Floyd, I'm sorry. It's been
Floyd?
A long time.
Floyd Lawton.
It's Lloyd.
Lloyd.
Yeah. Lloyd. He's like,
g'day,
mate.
Everybody else laughing. Anthony's like, that's not correct.
Yeah, he's trying to correct him.
Like, yeah, you were like wrong about that.
He's like, according to IMDb,
according to my headcanon, that is incorrect.
Headcanon. You didn't take into account for the butterfly effect.
I think at the end of the day, like, there were so many ways to.
Tell a better story.
Why is it like 75% of our 400 shows that we end up talking about Star Wars?
Because we love Star Wars.
We're nerds. That's what we're talking about.
I think it's funny.
Star Wars is amazing.
Should have had one.
So is Batman.
Batman. Look at that.
Nope.
Should have one. Look at that. That's Batman. You have one right above your head.
Mine's in a better spot. You want to know why?
Yeah.
Because I got one here and here.
Well, it's good because I'm actually glad that you can see the bat. Before, all you saw was like just the little tail. your camera was like right up in your face.
Yeah. No, yeah, it's good placement. Good placement.
Good placement.
You think about it. Right? The granddaughter of Pops would have had to have gotten busy at age 70, clapping cheeks at this. Yeah.
While he was there,
he's like, "Oh, I feel so the force is strong with you,
And she's like, "Just get it over with. You're more of a Skywalker."
Yeah, because like if you figure he was, you know, his child was born right around the same time, like Luke, Leia, maybe if not like a little bit before. So it's like, was he really getting it on at that old? Yeah, I could buy Palpatine getting it on. I mean, Ian McDermott at that time, like prequel time. Sure, I could buy it.
There were so many.
I don't even want to think about this.
Like we know that.
I mean, it doesn't make much sense, like, but I'm like, I can kind of see it.
Like the whole story with Snoke was that he literally conceived a child out of midichlorians. He manipulated.
Yo, Palps had so many concubines.
No, but Ryan, he's
dealing with dark science and cloning and a bunch of other shit too.
Plagueis literally conceived a child by manipulating midichlorians, and that's how you know his mother became pregnant, and she said, "Oh, there was no father." And they're like, "Oh, it's like a magic."
We've all seen the movies,
right? But what I'm saying is that I don't know.
They were enslaved by water.
The Lord of the Rings. I wouldn't talk, and you still refuse to watch them.
I don't refuse. I don't have time.
All the Spider-Man movies, but you wouldn't watch
I've watched
that?
Two. That's it. That's because my wife wanted to watch them.
That's 4 hours. Anyway. But the thing is that I almost thought at one point that Rey was going to be another version of what Plagueis did to Anakin in terms of Palpatine was able to
manipulate.
Yeah, and that would have made more sense. Like, oh, that's why the age is different and all, you know, whatever. No, instead he had a son who was a nobody. He was like, oh, I don't care. We got to run. It was just like, oh, come on. This is stupid.
Ryan Rivera, I've seen all of Lord of the Rings, just not the extended
edition. He hasn't seen it. He has not seen the
extended edition. He hasn't made an effort.
He refuses. He's like, I know they're out there, and they've existed longer than I have.
We've ridden down the Star Wars train for quite some time. Anyway.
Go on for hours. I mean, we could.
This could be a Star Wars
show. Mute them both.
It's true.
I got to get up in the morning to work. But so here we have one last bit of news that was announced today from several different sources. I'm just going to bring up the one for discussing film. Is that a sequel to The Accountant is happening with Ben Affleck and John Bernthal. You guys thoughts on this? Because I thought the first Accountant is absolute fucking fire. And to bring it full circle, if you go down in the chat, a surprise to be sure, but
well done.
I don't know. I just happened to scroll it before I popped it up there, and I saw it. And I was like, "Oh, that's good." and then you see somebody says, "About time." So yeah, what you guys thoughts, man? Because I thought the first one was an absolute fucking. I can watch that shit at any time. So, what you guys think, Phil?
Ecstatic! Absolutely freaking ecstatic! The Accountant is one of my favorite films. Gavin O'Connor's fantastic director. Obviously, Bernthal and Affleck have a really interesting chemistry, so it'll be interesting to see how they come back together for this second one. And if O'Connor's in the chair, it should deliver. So
yes,
I'm all for it.
No, I absolutely agree. The Accountant's a great movie. I think
what is this? Hold on, what is this, Andre?
This is for let's do it after we talk about the Accountant.
Okay.
Cinema.
That's something funny.
Yeah, but no, I'm stoked. I think that it'll be fantastic. It'll be great to see Ben Affleck, you know, continue on a story that he's already started before. Being Batman and everything, and mm-hmm. be able to just see how.
So, what's about Bruce Wayne?
Get this man out of my sight.
That's how he's going to view the movie. He's like,
this is Bruce Wayne.
There's a little bit of me that was like, oh, hey, Batman and Punisher beating the shit out of each other.
Yeah. He's like, whoa, it's an Elseworlds.
It's an Elseworlds.
What is this comment right here? Sorry in advance, Dawson.
Why are you apologizing to me?
I know.
I'm not a child. I am 24 years old.
You're childish.
You have tainted Dawson, Anthony. Yeah.
You scarred me for life. My gosh. How dare you?
Lynn's going to be like, I don't even know you.
I watched that stream. It was horrible. You monster.
You're a monster.
She doesn't watch Four Nerds.
My wife doesn't either. What's up, Master Blaster?
Master Blaster.
Oh, he said, "Boo this man!
Boo this man!
Boo this man!"
Accountant 2 to be fire.
It was great. Yeah, J.K. Yes, do this.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, J.K. Simmons.
Yeah, I can't wait to see Ben Affleck in another Warner Brothers picture.
Oh, yeah. Alex Lebo is trying to call you out.
24 years old.
Okay, so
where he can ride on any roller
coaster.
So
owning my own house, being married, working a stable job as being a kid.
Don't
he's got it. He's got it. He got me beat. All right, weird.
Good job, 18K, though. Folks.
Sounds like Virginia is the paradise.
I know.
No, it's really
I gotta
not.
Get to Virginia.
It's really not.
In California, you'd be screwed.
Oh man,
you're kind of screwed in Virginia too.
Hard as hell.
California.
All right, any last thoughts on the Accountant? Everybody excited? Everybody looking forward to it?
Do you have the artwork that I sent you in the Foreigners group chat? The BBS poster.
Yeah, hold on.
Tell me about the one you posted.
No, it was in the group chat. I posted it in there. Mm. I thought it was really cool.
What group chat are you talking about here?
The Four Nerds group chat.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Posted it today?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Like, I did see it. I actually saved it earlier today when I saw it, but it's pretty fire.
There's two posts you have shared.
You talking about Deathstroke?
No. is that a poster? No, it's not.
Oh yeah, because I did. I retweeted this. Come on, man.
I mean,
and the show has turned into a standstill.
Yeah.
This
poster here from Great Movie Posters really good.
Is pretty fire. Yes, it is. Awesome.
That was badass.
You need that on the wall.
Yeah. There's also a version of this, like a variant, where he has on the armored suit.
Ooh. Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
He's a variant? Does he know Loki?
It says, let's see. Yeah, somebody has it on their wall right here. This is.
Oh, wow. Look at that.
Ooh, yeah, I'd love to get that one.
Oh, yeah, he has the armor on.
Yeah, yeah. Nice.
Armor all. Yeah.
Yeah, I need that.
Armor all.
Yeah, I'm sure that's not what it's called, but okay.
which one would you guys rather have? This one or the one with the armor?
This one.
I don't know. Yeah, like probably this one too.
Yeah.
Probably this one.
Yeah. Yeah, that one's
pretty cool. So the accountant, who knows when it's gonna start production or be finished, but shit's gonna be fire.
Yes, it is.
I wonder what it's gonna be called. Yeah, accountants.
The accountants.
It's probably like tax season.
The accountant two tax season.
Are you old night in February?
Do you want to watch a movie that totally just destroys all
back taxes?
No, it's called The Accountant, The Loophole.
Wait, I got it. Tax evasion.
Oh, yeah.
The Accountant, tax evasion.
Yes, that's definitely what's going
to
be called.
In theaters, HBO Max.
Yeah.
After 45 days.
After 45 days. Like, why? What's happening? I don't understand.
So what is this I'm about to share?
Some of you guys may have seen this already. I thought it was hilarious. This is.
Oh, hey. Do you see it? Oh, there you go. Oh, what is this?
This is a school board meeting, some kids pranked the school board.
Ahead of time. Right, like The Simpsons. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. You guys work for us in this environment. You answer to us, and I'm asking that you do not pass this policy in Virginia.
Thank you.
Oh, hey, Virginia.
Virginia.
Dawson's was like, this I had Dawson? No idea this happened.
Phil McCrank?
Hold on. Ryan, shut up.
Phil McCracken. Phil McCracken. Salk. Sook. Mahidic. Luke Mahidic.
Oh, Ryan's mad. Hang in there, Ryan. Ophelia You'll be all McHawk.
Right. Ophelia McHawk. Eileen Dover.
What the fuck, dude? Is going
Eileen to? Dover.
He's like, okay, I'm cross the name off the list.
Don Kiedick. Don Kiedick.
Nobody that's on that panel with him could be like, yo, dude, chill.
Wayne Kerr. Wayne Kerr.
I just thought that was funny because I was like, dude, how did you not know?
I can't believe nobody on that entire panel.
I don't know if that's real.
No, that's real.
Because it's a mask. It could just be like voiceover.
ADR, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah. I'm pretty confident that's real. Because if they're in a serious situation like that, they're not just going to assume that it's a prank.
Somebody should be like, yo, dude.
Yeah, someone should be like, hey, chill out. Give me the list.
Yeah, because I think somebody would have caught it. Like, someone on that panel would have been like, oh, I get it.
Especially when he said Eileen Dover. Like, okay, hell yeah.
Eileen
Dover. Because he's the one saying it, but everybody else, it's kind of like those things. I think everybody's done this to at least somebody in their family. You know, give them a sheet of paper and let them read it. And it has something like that, you know. Everyone else kind of, they, you know, audibly they hear you and they're like, oh, okay, you know, and everybody's laughing, but the person reading it doesn't get it. So yeah, I think somebody would have come to the guy and like, hey, dude.
Is this Aladdin?
It could be. No, that.
Oh, this is a good Cinderella. One. This is from Cinderella.
This is the newest one. This one's awesome. All right,
this is what he's been working on the whole time.
Yeah, this is it. This is
the stardust in there. This is stardust.
You look like you belong on the set of the CW Powerpuff Girls reboot.
Hey, I look in better shape than I do now. I love it.
Nice. What is this?
Okay, so this was another thing I wanted to talk about. So,
I did see this. I did.
Where basically in IMDb it says, yes. Kenny Knight stunt double for Harry Lennox. Do you think that are we going to get some kind of Harry Lennox in this movie, or do you think that's just somebody who put that in there?
I don't know.
I don't know. Is IMDb, can like anybody go in there and just add shit to it?
I think
if you have a pro account, I think, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Because like, I mean,
I can't remember the last time that I've seen a stunt double featured in an IMDb list with the actor's name that they're stunt double.
Yeah, I mean, like, her, Eunice, is, well, she's a coordinator, but Sunny
stunt
Lewis,
performer, stunt performer,
nothing. Ansko.
For them to be specific, like
he very well,
you know,
he could be stunting for somebody else in the movie, not specifically Mary Linus.
Even but. The bigger stunt doubles like Samantha Wynn or Richard Citrone.
They do multiple, you know, characters in the show. Whatever the scene calls for. That's, I mean, just like Citrone comes out. He was Batman, Darkseid, Steppenwolf. You know, he was multiple people. You know, whatever they needed in that scene, that's who he was, and that's why I don't think it's real, because it's specific.
I mean, if Harry Lennox was in this movie,
he'd be General Swanwick.
He'd be General Swanwick. But why would he need a stunt performer? Yeah. He's like, we're gonna fall
over. He's like, yeah.
If not, to like wire someone up and maybe have him fly around Martian Manhunter style, maybe.
Yeah, like
maybe.
No,
big.
I don't think we're gonna get Martian Manhunter anything.
I don't either.
If we did,
this movie already has
Loki.
This movie already has like a stacked amount of characters in it, and we don't even know who all is really gonna be in it yet.
So. Yeah, I mean, you know, Harry might be in it. You know, he might be in the film. Because what I see him being in the film for is Sasha Kaye, because
that is a good point.
You know, in this version or whatever, you know, he has her under wraps. So,
what the? I never thought about that. The person, what if when they open the cell and there's a, you know, a Sasha Kaye all like frail and whatever. What if it's Harry Lennox is the one?
Swanwick.
Who helps them like locate her, or like maybe in this universe, you know, he's trying to stop them.
He plays the role of Cyborg in a sense, where he's like,
it could be.
You know what? Yeah, you might be onto something there, because if they're not going to use Ray Fisher, but they were going to use somebody else from that universe,
why not use Martian Manhunter or use Swanwick?
Right. They're not using Martian Manhunter. If they did, that'd be dope. I want to say, you know, Warner Brothers.
I feel like Swanwick is a strong possibility because of everything you just said, but Martian Manhunter is a bit more of a gamble. I'll agree to that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because they want to avoid
if he's even in the movie.
But if you have Swanwick in the movie, then he's technically, he is Martian Manhunter, because he was, you know, that scene was put out. So then you have to say, okay, is he acting as Swanwick, and is he going to reveal himself at one point in this storyline?
In the Flash movie, but it wasn't established that he's Martian Manhunter in any other incarnation that Warner Brothers is.
If you're saying that Justice League is the is a direct canon,
I'm saying Justice League is the direct. Okay,
Walter. Sorry. Then yes, yeah, then he is. Then he is just Swanwick.
You apologize to
he Walter. Is Swanwick the human.
Yes, Swanwick the human. Yes,
but then that would be lame.
Yeah, it would be.
That'd be Warner Brothers.
It sucks too, because like the Flash has like a lot of characters directly from like Zack Snyder's Justice League. Yeah. Saber, you know, you've got Ron Livingston now taking over the role of Henry Allen.
Yeah,
and then Kiersey Clemons returning, because she wasn't in the theatrical cut. Mm-hmm. She was in Zack Snyder's cut
because she was contracted to be in this film.
Yeah, that is true too.
I think they were just like, we're just going to honor the contract. That role is not really important because he's going to be running around, and doing things with Michael Keaton. So,
and himself.
At the end of the day, I still 110% believe Ray Fisher needs to be on that production. I will continue.
Yes,
absolutely,
100%. I agree.
But unfortunately, I think that ship has sailed. I don't think there's any way they can put him on there. It just depends on how far they are in
production. I don't disagree, but even still, like I will still say that of him, 100%. Yeah. Like I stay
with that. He should have been in the movie.
That's why I 100% agree with what Gavin Cooley says here, where I'm keeping my expectations super low for The Flash.
Yeah.
Yes. Sure.
You know,
I agree with that.
I think at Fandom, you know, similar to what Phil was saying, you know, I'm more excited for the Batman and Black Adam, but I think that they are going to put a lot into The Flash, because I mean, this is literally their turning point. I mean, if you look at who's the regime, who's in charge, they're like, this movie has to hit on all fronts.
Yeah.
If it doesn't,
then you're basically
heads will roll.
Heads will roll, but then you still have Black Adam that's going to hit. But this has to establish your universe to some degree. And if you don't hit those marks, then you've, again, you've wasted time creating an entertaining movie that didn't actually accomplish anything.
Well, and my big fear with the Flash, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, Anthony.
No.
My big fear with the Flash is that with this movie, obviously with any film, you have to make money. You have to earn a return. You have to earn a return.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. My worry is that with Warner Bros. Being as petty as they are, that I'm not saying that they're going to do this, but I wouldn't put it past them, is if they decide, okay, we gave you the Flash movie, gave you Michael Keaton, Ben Affleck, and if it's not financially successful, they could simply say, well, I guess you don't want DC characters anymore. I mean, they won't stop making DC films, but they'd be like, you don't want this whole cohesive universe.
I can see that, because I mean, the same thing with the guy that we're talking about from Disney, the Iger. He was like, well, there's fatigue, you know. Yeah, that's why they're not showing up. There's Star Wars fatigue. So yeah, I can see him doing that because they want to spin that narrative to where they're not wrong. It's it's you. It's you, the audience. It's you, the people spending money. Y'all aren't spending money, so you must not want it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I think as far as the Flash is concerned, I personally, in my mind, I think it could end one of two ways. And one way is it ends in that, you know, Barry has screwed up the universes respectively, but at the end, they stay separate unto their own. And it's a multiverse, right?
Right.
Or it ends and the world that Barry is now in is now kind of a hodgepodge of things that we've seen before, like Keaton's Batman and this new Supergirl and a couple of things. And this is the new like EU going forward. But we still also get all these other side stories like Peacemaker and Blue Beetle, Batgirl, blah, 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 blah. But even then, like you get to like if Batman's the new Batman in the DCEU and J.K. Simmons is still Jim Gordon, Batman's now older than Jim Gordon. And that's it's not like,
yeah.
It's funky. Stupid. It's really funky. And I'm kind of with Andre in that the Flash movie is what will determine whether or not WB really wants to continue with any kind of straightforward narrative across a multitude of films or not.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And
I can agree with that. Yeah.
Yeah. Also, 1000% think that whatever Warner Brothers was planning on showing from this movie at Fandom, I think it probably have changed now.
When your
entire big time, like online convention, gets out tweeted by Restore the Snyderverse, guarantee that's just gonna happen again. But like whatever plans they had going into DC Fandom, they're like, God damn it, we still can't get away from. So they're gonna do something. I would suggest something as grand as seeing Keaton in his suit in a fucking Flash footage.
Wouldn't be surprised.
Something to try.
Are you talking about at Fandom or are you talking about before Fandom?
Yes.
No, at Fandom.
I can see that. I could absolutely see that happening. Yes.
Yeah, I see that. Yeah.
It's a thing where they put this stuff out, they put the trailer out, they put that garbage poster out, and then all of a sudden they're still getting, no matter what they announce with anything Fandom, it gets out trended by Restore the Snyderverse. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure they're tired of it. I mean, one way to combat that, Warner Brothers, would be to just fucking restore the Snyderverse. Then you won't have to do that shit. No. But yes, I think that the plans that they had, that stupid thing that leaked with the flying babies,
yes,
or whatever, they'll probably still show that, but there will be something extra there. There's no, they if they want to combat that in any way, shape, or form, their plans have changed for Fandom. Like there's going to be something different there that they hadn't planned on having to show. Because
they had to retool that, right? They had to retool the flying baby thing because it got leaked. So they have to make it
leaking earlier than they did last year.
Yeah,
remember, like hours before the Batman stuff dropped, photos started dropping of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Like this, we could see some other leaks from some other stuff. I think that's possible.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, but if they're watching, they just don't want to listen to what
they're having meetings, but the meetings are about
beat Restore the Snyderverse, not how do we cater to the fans and make them happy.
And that's where you go wrong, because not you guys, but that's where Warner Bros. Goes wrong, is because
we're not wrong.
It's because
you're wrong.
At this point, they're so worried about beating something else in entertainment rather than making something that's actually good.
Yeah.
And when you focus on beating somebody else, it's like there's this idiot on Twitter who tweeted the other day.
Beating themselves.
Oh, Andre.
No, that. But but it's like the other day, this person tweeted out a picture of Superman drawn by Jorge Jimenez and said, "I'm pretty sure I could make a Superman movie better than Zack Snyder." And Ray from Flycast put it very well, saying, "No, you can't, because automatically, even if you had the training, your intent is to make a movie better than somebody else and not just to simply create something."
Yeah, not something original.
And when that happens, it's evident what you're doing. If you're just simply creating for the sake of creating and making something cool, that's when it works out. And that's what the story of the Snyderverse is about. But now they're just simply about trying to make people forget about something that was actually really cool. Mm-hmm. And it's evident.
Well, and that's the whole thing about the poster. Like, people are like, well, you know, Cavill or whoever, they're not on the poster because they don't have anything lined up for those characters. It's like, yeah, no shit. The idea is that you can have everything you have in this poster. That's fine. But to me, it's not fair to exclude all the fans who liked what essentially the Snyderverse had established. It's not fair to exclude all of them and say, hey, we gave you what you wanted. Now go away, because here comes our new bright and beautiful DC universe. Instead, you would think they would say, you know, we need to keep those. We need to keep those fans and keep them incorporated in what we're doing, because that's a bigger fan base. That's more of a fan base that we want to have coming back to our product and supporting our brand in our products, and not, you know, doing the opposite. But they don't think that way. They're thinking, no, we're going to move forward. We're going to move on. We're going to ignore that and give you we're going to give you this because it's going to be good. Trust us. Instead of saying, hey, we know what you guys want. Yeah. I want to make sure we're catering to these fans as well, and we're catering to all these fans as well. Because at the end of the day, you're all consumers. You all like the characters that we're putting out. Let's do this. You know, let's bring everyone together.
Let's go.
And no, but they don't want to do that. Though. They don't want to do that.
No. That's evident by their actions since and before Zack Snyder's Justice League was released. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you guys so much for tuning in. We have hit almost 2.5 hours. Thank you, Phil, so much for being a guest on the show. It's been a fire time, as always.
Anytime. Thank you guys so much for the invite.
Of course.
I'm sure, you know, all you guys be invited to tomorrow night. But real quick, before we bounce, we gave out, like I said earlier in the show, we gave out some digital codes for Snake Eyes last week. If you weren't able to get the digital codes, here's where you could find them.
Get early access to Snake Eyes G.I. Joe Origins on digital today. In this action-packed adventure the critics are calling the best G.I. Joe movie yet, the iconic hero Snake Eyes rises to become the ultimate warrior in the battle against Cobra. Buy Snake Eyes G.I. Joe Origins on digital today and get all new special features, including a bonus short film, deleted scenes, and much more, available at participating retailers. Rated PG-13 from Paramount Pictures.
I also put in a link for your podcast.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
That is in the chat. Right. There it is. Check him out, Superhero Stress. And they also have a new show with Ryan Rivera, who's in the chat.
Yeah, he's got his show on The Real Burn on YouTube. We do a couple commentaries. We've been trying to – we haven't set down a date for Wonder Woman yet, but I'm sure that'll happen sometime soon.
Oh, Wonder Woman 84? You're going to talk about fire?
No. 2017, the first one.
Relax.
Yeah.
Craig.
Appreciate it. So, Phil, man, tell everybody where they can find you.
Well, if y'all want to follow me along, just on Vero, Twitter, Instagram, it's just at that. There we go. That. Just at Unfiltered. You guys can listen to my show, just Superhero Stress, search for it, Podbean, Apple Podcast. You can also listen to the other two shows I do, The Magical Movies, which only has 2 episodes, and The Eternal Night, which has 3 episodes. I'm still trying to get stuff down and ready for them, but in due time. There are pretty brand new shows. But thank you again, guys, for the invite. It's been always a lot of fun talking to all four of you on your respective shows and channels. It's always just been really welcoming. Just thank you so much.
Enjoy. Of course. And then here's where you can find us. You can find the four nerds on our relative social media platforms.
On our sister stations.
On the socials.
This is also pretty much the same with like Barrel and Instagram.
Smash the like.
Like and subscribe.
Please.
No, Dawson, you told us you can't say please.
I'm mocking you.
Can't say please.
Now please. You ruined it.
You ruined it. Please.
He said please. People are no. They don't like
all mockery. Oh,
Grace Randolph.
So.
my ears. I wasn't ready for that.
Yo, that's just so loud when it comes in. But anyway, thank you guys for tuning in. As always, we'll see you guys next Thursday. We are Four Nerds.